Hello, good morning. You're watching the News Hour on GMTV. It's just gone 6 o'clock. We'll have more on all of those stories in the next hour.
Also this morning, more evidence of problems with child support as the CSA looks set to miss key targets despite employing 1,000 more staff.
And heading to Hollywood to find out what Madonna said to Oprah. Get in touch with us on any of those subjects this morning. You can text us on the usual number, 81189, or email us at our website, gm.tv. Let's get some weather now with Andrea.
Thanks very much, John. Good morning. We've got some wet weather coming in from the south and west through this morning. As you can see, we do have a fair amount of cloud across the UK through today. We've also got some rain across some parts of Scotland. As we go into this afternoon, what we will see is that area of rain nudging its way northwards, merging with the rain that's already there across parts of Scotland. Heaviest rain expected to be around the Borders region during the course of today. And temperatures will be fairly varied. As you can see, only 8 or 9 degrees across the far north of Scotland, faring a little bit better the further south that you go. But they are steadily getting cooler and fresher as we work our way towards November. John.
Thanks very much indeed, Andrea. Our top story this morning, support for the Labour Party has dropped to its lowest level for almost 20 years, according to a poll out in one of the newspapers. Just 29% of voters say they now back Labour, and the majority cite the government's record on health as its biggest failing. Sue Jamieson is at Westminster for us this morning. Not too good reading for Mr Blair this morning, Sue.
No, I don't think he's going to need a calculator to work this out, really. We've got Labour on 29%, the Tories on 39%, Lib Dems on 22%, and that is the lowest Labour score since 1987, which was just before Margaret Thatcher got her third term in office. And you're right, health is one of the major issues. 3 out of 4 people asked thought that what they called a lot of the money that Labour has invested, and after all, it's doubled its investment in the NHS since 1997, they thought a lot of that money had been wasted. Only 1 in 4 people thought that the NHS had actually improved. Now, of course, there'll be a lot of Labour MPs looking at this as more evidence that they need a fresh start, somebody new at the helm, more pressure perhaps on Mr Blair to go, although he says, of course, that he never takes any notice of polls.
Yes, indeed. But there is more uncomfortable reading for him as well with regard to the very controversial CSA.
Yeah, a pretty much permanent headache for the government, this one. This is the Tories looking at the latest figures on the Child Support Agency. The government had said that it would reduce the backlog of their new outstanding cases by 25% from March this year to March next year. Now, the half-yearly figures have just been published, and it's 9%. So, obviously, way off target at the moment. Now, the Tories say this just shows it's shambolic, despite the fact that 1,000 more staff have been recruited. The Works and Pensions Department have said, well, these are only half-yearly figures and it's going to get a lot better because we're putting in much more training, so perhaps by March next year we'll meet the target. I imagine there's going to be large pinches of salt all over the place on that one.
So thanks very much to you. We'll be pursuing that story about the CSA a little bit later in the programme.
But first, it's time to get this morning's other news stories. Good morning, Amanda.
Good morning, Gloria. Good morning. Drivers of gas-guzzling vehicles could be penalised for damaging the environment. Under the plan, drivers of the most polluting cars could be charged almost £500 to park outside their own homes. Well, Rachel Harrison is in Richmond in Surrey, where the scheme is under consideration. Rachel, good morning to you. These really are tough measures, aren't they?
Yes, absolutely. Well, they're trying to do something about climate change and reduce the amount of carbon emissions. This is going to be the first area in the country and the first time a council has actually penalised gas-guzzling vehicles, but it could be brought in everywhere if it's successful. So how will it work? Well, it's quite simple. Anyone with a 4x4 or one of the larger cars like a BMW or a Jaguar will go from paying £100 to park outside their own home to £300. Added that to the fact that if you are a two-car owner family, then you will have your bills increased by another 50%. So the worst case scenario is that you'll be paying £750 a year. However, if you choose to buy one of the new hybrids or have a car with low emissions like one of the smart cars, you could have a very discounted rate and even park for free. Now, the idea is that this plan will actually reduce emissions by around 15%, which is, of course, great news for the environment, but it is very bad news if you're the driver of the vehicle behind me.
Absolutely, Rachel. Many thanks for that. Women who give birth late in life risk having infertile daughters. Researchers claim the decline in fertility in older women can cause genetic damage, which may be passed on to female children. The age of the father appears to have no impact. Doctors now hope to extend the initial study of 74 women. 3 million elderly people could die before they see any benefit from a promised increase in pensions. Campaigners will go to Downing Street today with a 100,000-strong petition calling for the link between pensions and earnings to be restored. They say delaying pension reform is consigning millions to poverty. Now, children are being urged to wear fluorescent clothing to and from school to prevent deaths and accidents on our roads. It's part of the government's Be Safe, Be Seen campaign to encourage youngsters to be as visible as possible as the lights draw in. Well, Emma Louise Johnston has been to one school in Glasgow who have already adopted the message.
Nearly 3,500 children were killed or seriously injured on our roads last year. Almost half of these tragedies happened between 3 and 6 p.m. And so parents and children are being asked to act responsibly and to be safe and be seen.
The lights are fair drawn in and all that. So yes, we've got the reflective clothing and Andrew's been wearing that to school.
Well, we received one of the high luminous jackets for the early nights coming in. And it's quite a good idea, actually.
You've got to put it on so cars can see you.
I think the school should provide them if people can't afford them, but I think it's a great idea.
The main message is make yourself visible, wear fluorescent by day and make sure it's reflective in the dark. Emma Louise Johnston, GMTV News, Langside Primary, Glasgow.
Finally, the long-awaited musical Dirty Dancing has wowed the audience on its first night. It's already the fastest-selling West End musical and last night Michael Underwood was there as the record-breaking show took to the stage.
Dirty Dancing was one of the cult hit movies of the 80s, and now nearly two decades on, it opens on the West End stage, where a whole host of famous faces turned out to show their support. Tickets for the show have only been available for the last 6 weeks, and yet they've sold £12 million worth, making it the fastest selling West End musical of all time. So what's the secret to the show's success?
Legendary film, legendary characters, the whole, you know, romance on the holiday, what more could you want?
I think maybe it connects with the secret dancer inside people and the idea that they suspect that dancing can transform their lives.
We all got lost in the film, that's what it was. We all want to be that girl, didn't we? We all wanted to dance with the wonderful Patrick Swayze, and I can't wait to see it on stage.
Dirty Dancing is the hottest ticket in town, having sold out till May 2007. So if you don't already have a ticket booked, you've got quite some time to wait before you see why nobody puts baby in the corner. Michael Underwood, GMTV News.
At present time now to very nearly 8 minutes past six. I'm back at 6:30. Here's John and Gloria.
Thanks, Amanda. We'll take a look at the morning papers. The Independent splashes on Iraq and the indication yesterday from its one of its most senior generals that there is a timetable for substantial withdrawal by American troops in that country. The Daily Telegraph says that schools may be allowed to return to a more rigorous exam system abandoned when the GCSE replaced O-levels. Picture of Robin Knox Johnson, who, of course, has had to return to port along with several other sailors involved in that event because of rough season in Bay of Biscay. £1,000 instant fines for immigrant workers. That's the announcement yesterday about Bulgarians and Romanians, although the government admits it will be very difficult to police. And finally, in The Guardian, ministers bow to pressure for a climate bill. That's indication that they'll agree plans today for a climate change bill, setting new long-term targets to cut carbon emissions.
Quick look at the tabloids now in the Daily Mirror. More of that Richard Hammond interview, saying that he does want to be behind the wheel again, but probably not in the jet car that nearly killed him. In the Daily Express, a story of a Christian woman who was suspended by British Airways for wearing a cross. She's been on the American TV channels.
What amazed me about that story, they seem to be suspended for appearing on American TV. She's on GMTV last week, saying exactly the same thing.
GMTV, if you appear on GMTV, it's all fine, obviously.
Yeah.
The Sun claims that Kate Moss claims to have a go at Lady McCartney in that heated divorce trial. And in the Daily Mail, because they're going to reband council tax bans, they claim that council snoopers will be able to enter your home and take photos in any room of home improvements, which could mean higher bills.
As well as charging you £750 to park outside your own home. Let's move on to sport now before I get angry. So 9 minutes past six is the time. Busy night of Carling Cup football, dominated by several upsets. With me now to talk about them is Kelly Dalglish, West Ham United. Oh, my. Good heavens.
And if you think you've got it bad with £750 to pay outside your house and council snoopers coming into the house, it could be worse. It could be Alan Pardew this morning.
You could be a West Ham supporter. Having said that, Chesterfield knocked out Manchester City. It has to be acknowledged in the previous round. But this was a big shock and it's bad news for Pardew, isn't it?
Well, this really was a match that West Ham had to win because they're out of the UEFA Cup. They're a terrible position in the Premiership. And they led through Marlon Harewood. But unfortunately, Colin Larkin came back to level for Chesterfield. And then finally, it was Caleb Folan who got the winner with just a few minutes to go in this match, and it sent Chesterfield through to the fourth round. So great excitement for them at their home ground. But for West Ham, I mean, I suppose the verdict is that it's just not good enough. And Alan Pardew was honest enough to say that about the performance as well.
Yes, worst run in 74 years. Lots of action to get through, so let's press on. Sheffield United out as well.
Yes, I know, and they actually led in this game as well against Birmingham. A couple of goals early on, which we haven't really got time to show, but Nicholas Bentner with this effort, and really some of the defending from Sheffield United is going to make Neil Warnock even more cross than he normally is. Cameron Jerome also weighing in with a goal, and then Seb Larsson. And then later on, look at this, Seb Larsson's goal. I don't think the Sheffield United defenders realise you can't be offside from a throw-in. And Seb Larsson was on hand to take full advantage. But, you know, Sheffield United did manage to get a late one back from a Nick Montgomery.
Indeed. And I'll tell you else is in trouble. That's Leeds United, of course. They're second bottom of the second division. Dennis Wise, their new manager, was paraded before the crowd. A meagre crowd at that. Only just over 10,000 there last night. To see them lose to Southend.
Well, yeah, Dennis Wise wasn't actually in charge for this game, but he will be in charge at the weekend when Leeds face Southend again, this time in the league. They're second and third bottom, but a really disappointing result for Leeds. Stephen Hamill got a penalty after Stephen Craney's foul on Mark Gower, and then it was Gary Hooper who got a couple of goals for Southend. Ian Moore with the reply for Leeds United a little bit later on. But, I mean, for Leeds United, for such a huge club, it's just real disappointment. And as you say, nobody's turning up to watch them. Dennis Wise really has his hands full and he really has a huge task there. But he's with his old friend Ken Bates, so we'll see what happens, because he'll definitely have the backing of him.
Yeah, indeed. And I'm not sure he has the full support of the Leeds crowd, nevertheless, with the Chelsea connection. But there we go. Notts County, we should praise as well, because they knocked out Southampton last night.
They did manage to knock out Southampton.
2-0 at Notts County, which is a good victory for them.
It's a fantastic victory for them. And Southampton haven't necessarily been playing particularly well in the Championship. But yeah, Notts County did really well. They knocked out Palace and Borough earlier in the League Cup as well, so good run.
Great match tonight at Crewe. Not often we say that
on
the news out, but it is a great game for them because they've got Manchester United.
It does, and it matches the two longest-serving managers in Britain as well. So you've got Dario Gradi of Crewe against Alex Ferguson of Manchester United, and Alan Smith will make his first start since breaking his leg.
Absolutely. MK Dons up against Spurs too. That'd be a potential upset there as well.
Be.
Kelly, good to see you. Thanks so much for being with us.
Good morning. You're watching the News Hour on GMTV. This morning's headlines. Support for the Labour Party has dropped to its lowest level for almost 20 years. Just 29% of voters say they now back Labour.
Owners of gas-guzzling vehicles could be penalised under a new plan, with drivers of the most polluting cars charged hundreds of pounds to park outside their homes at Richmond in Surrey.
And the long-awaited stage show Dirty Dancing has opened and broken records in London, where it's officially the fastest-selling West End musical of all time. Now, the go-ahead could be given today for the first ever complete face transplant. A surgeon at a London hospital wants permission to carry out pioneering operations to replace a whole disfigured face with one from a donor. Well, joining us now is Dr. Ian Hutchinson, a surgeon from the charity Saving Faces. Good morning.
Thanks. Good morning.
Coming in now, what a huge advance in medical science. Would this be a positive development?
Well, it isn't actually a huge advance in medical science, because as Peter Butler, the surgeon from the Royal Free that you mentioned, would say, the surgical techniques have been available for 20 years. The drugs to suppress the body's immune response have been available for 20 years. What is new is the possibility that this ethics committee is going to give the go-ahead for surgery in Britain. Because, of course, there has been a face transplant in France. There's been one in China, and there's been one in another country in the past 12 months. There is a category of patients who would benefit from it, but they're very few in number. They're burns patients mainly, because we can reconstruct the underlying bone structure very, very well, but we can't use skin from elsewhere in the body effectively on the face, because the face is so unique in its texture and the like. This poor ethics committee, though, has been under scrutiny by the media for the past 6 months, because they've met three times and they've, you know, the media have trotted us out to talk about it. So I feel sorry for the ethics committee being under the spotlight all the time.
Yeah, you can see why there are such huge ethical considerations, because, as I understand it, and explain it if you would, the donor would still be clinically alive if they...
Well, They would be brain dead, but their heart would be beating. So I mentioned that there would be very few patients who actually need it, burns victims mainly. Similarly, I think there are going to be very few donors who are prepared to give their face. I mean, I may choose to write saying I'm prepared to give my face. When I actually am on the intensive care unit with my heart still beating, my children may say, well, we don't want daddy's face removed. So, you know, because how are you going to grieve over somebody? It's not the same as taking a heart or a liver or a kidney, which can't be seen. It's taking the face off.
But would a person who received a face transplant, would they look like the donor?
No. They're going to look like a hybrid. They're going to look more like the recipient. It's really just, you know, to put it simply, it's a facelift removed from one person and draped on the other. I mean, it's a bit like, if you change the colour of this sofa by putting on different drapes, you're not changing the shape. It's changing from a red sofa to a blue sofa, but the shape remains the same. And so that's exactly what's happening with a face transplant.
And it would be incredibly complicated surgery, and the tissue could be rejected, couldn't it? What would happen? How would that?
Well, that's where we come into the problem for the recipient and the recipient's family. They're at risk of having rejection of the tissue over the whole of their lives, really. In the first few days, the blood vessels that we have to join up, the very tiny blood vessels, may block with clot.
Right.
But then over time, the immunosuppressant drugs, which are very, very strong indeed, may not work, and they may have to have increasing doses. For instance, the man who had the hand transplant, I don't know whether you remember that, at the end of the 90s, he stopped taking the immunosuppressants and the hand had to be removed because he didn't like the side effects of the immunosuppressants. And so the point about a heart transplant and a liver and a kidney transplant is that they save lives. This is a quality of life transplant.
Fine.
Very important because people can be suicidal with facial disfigurement, but it's a different order of things.
So a huge decision expected today. Thanks very much for explaining that for us this morning. Thank you.
Thank you.
Time now is 17 minutes past six. You're watching the News Hour here on GMTV. Let me tell you, we were amazed by the massive response we had yesterday to our item about postnatal depression. Here's a couple of the video phone messages which we've received from you, our viewers.
Hello, my name is Vanessa from Wiltshire. I have postnatal depression, which would leave me crying for days for no apparent reason.
Hi, I'm Jem from Reading. I suffered postnatal depression 9 years ago. I felt like I wanted to die. Like someone would take my baby away from me. I felt so alone. I just wish people would understand and try and help rather than judge.
Well, please keep your video messages on postnatal depression coming. All you have to do is record a message, then send it to this number, 07739 672673. It'll cost you 50 pence plus your usual picture rate. Now, we're also contacted by one lady from Warwick who was diagnosed with postnatal depression for a second time at the beginning of the week. Jackie Kabler is with her this morning. Morning to you, Jackie.
Good morning, John. Yes, we were absolutely swamped yesterday, weren't we, as you said, and one of the people who called us was this lady. This is Shelley Burns O'Regan, here with her husband, Tim, and her little boy, Callum. And this looks like a really happy picture, but in reality, Shelley was going through hell. And for 2 years, and many people don't believe it can last that long, she was first diagnosed with postnatal depression when Callum was 8 months old. She was treated briefly and thought everything would be okay, but it wasn't. And just this week on Monday, she was diagnosed for the second time with postnatal depression. Well, Tim and Shelley, join me now. Good morning to you. Callum's still in bed. We will meet him a little bit later on. Now, Shelley, 2 years you've been going through this. Just talk me through briefly some of the way you've been feeling.
Well, the last week it really came to a head and I've been incredibly weepy. I can't do the simplest of tasks. I'm battling to sleep. I have persistent headaches. So just I feel like my life has spiralled out of control.
And little things like you said you couldn't even remember your son's birth date, which must have been really shocking for you.
Absolutely devastating, because people say it's the most important day of your life. How could you not remember your child's birthday?
Yeah.
And I have a mental block about this date. You just lack concentration.
Terrible. I know one of the things that we've got from women who've called the programme are that you were maybe frightened to seek help because you thought maybe the baby would be taken away from you.
I was terrified because I didn't know what the procedure was, if we would be put in a certain category, that I wasn't a fit mother. And I was really, really concerned that he would be taken away from me.
Awful, so distressing. And Tim, I know the man is often forgotten in all this, but for you it must have been difficult as well, watching your wife go through this and maybe not really understanding.
It is very difficult for the man, because men like to try and solve things, and if you don't know what there is to solve, you actually can't solve it. So it's a relief to us to now know what it is so that we can actually work on how we can best find a way for Shelley to recover.
Absolutely. Shelley, are you surprised that it's taken 2 years to get this diagnosis again? Did you realise it could go on this long?
No, I had no idea. I mean, as you said, I was diagnosed with it when he was 8 months old, and I was on treatment for a month, and then I thought I got over it. Mm-hmm. But foolishly stopped the medication after a month, thinking I was okay. Mm. And in hindsight, that was the worst thing I could have done.
Mm. And at least you're getting treatment now, so that's fantastic.
Yeah.
It's great that you're getting treatment. Thanks so much for having us here, and we'll be talking to the couple a little bit later on. But yeah, just one in hundreds of people who can't tell it's yesterday. Such a widespread problem, John.
Jackie, thanks very much, Dee. Dr. Hillary is with us. He's been monitoring your calls and emails as well. Just before we get onto those, Hillary, I mean, is it usual for postnatal depression to go on for that long?
It's not unusual at all. I mean, we see women who've had postnatal depression for years, and it's been under-recognised and under-treated. And that's the tragedy, because it does, as we've heard, affect families. Certainly for the partners, the male partners of mothers with depression, it's very difficult to understand. I mean, they're not trained to recognise the symptoms. They wouldn't understand why the mother of their baby isn't happy with the baby they may have waited years to have, why she's not coping, why mentally she's not functioning at a level that they're used to. And undoubtedly it breaks relationships up if they don't get the help that they want.
And the other thing that Shelley identified, I'm sure, is common in many other cases as well, is her reluctance to sort of admit this for fear of having the baby taken away or social services intervening.
It's a very common fear that because the part of the depression means you feel guilty about what you're doing or what you're not doing, or you feel inadequate, that someone will take your baby away. And these are kind of almost irrational fears. That is not going to happen. What is going to happen is that you're going to get support. You're going to get some counselling, you're going to get to talking therapy, you're going to be put in touch with other mums who have felt the same or do feel the same. You're going to get support from health visitors who, if necessary, can visit on a daily basis. You might get treatment with antidepressants, which can be very effective in this condition. And of all the hundreds of emails that we've had, the overriding thing is that it does get better. And whilst it was the worst experience of their life at the time, that with help and with medication it does get better, there's light at the end of the tunnel, and the message is go and seek help as soon as you possibly can, because the longer it goes on, the worse it is. But, you know, it's treatable, eminently treatable.
Excellent news. You can join Dr. Hillary for a live video web chat at 9:30 this morning on this subject. So if you have any questions, any problems coping with postnatal depression, log on to gm.tv if you have that facility, or maybe someone you know can do it on your behalf. But he's there to answer all your queries. Thanks, Hillary.
Thanks, John.
Good morning. The time is 6:23, and we're going over to Los Angeles now and Carla Romano, where Hollywood's awash with baby talk. Good morning to you, Carla. Lovely to see you. Before we move on to the baby talk, let's start with a more serious story about Michael J. Fox.
Yeah, this is a story, Gloria, that really has shocked America. Michael J. Fox sparked a little bit of controversy by appearing in a political advert for a Democratic Senate candidate who supports stem cell research. Now, this is clearly an issue very close to Michael J. Fox's heart. As we know, he suffers from Parkinson's disease. And as you'll be able to see in just a second, he is visibly shaking in this ad. Take a look.
As you might know, I care deeply about stem cell research. In Missouri, you can elect Claire McCaskill, who shares my hope for cures. Unfortunately, Senator Jim Talent opposes expanding stem cell research. Senator Talent even wanted to criminalize the science that gives us a chance for hope. They say all politics is local, but it's not always the case. What you do in Missouri matters to millions of Americans, Americans like me.
Okay, so you're probably asking why so controversial. The man clearly has Parkinson's disease. Well, I'll tell you why. Because one conservative radio DJ here, his name is Rush Limbaugh, you might have heard of him, has said that he just doesn't buy it. He said that he thinks that Michael J. Fox is either acting or was off his medication, that he's never ever seen him like that. And he thinks that basically what's happening is that Michael J. Fox's illness is being exploited for political gain. Michael J. Fox, very gracious when he heard what Rush Limbaugh had to say. This was his reaction.
Well, it's hard for people, and I understand it's difficult for people that don't have Parkinson's or don't know about Parkinson's to understand the symptoms and the way they work and the way medication works. You get what you get on any given day.
As I said, incredibly gracious. And who'd be surprised, Gloria, if this radio DJ has barricaded himself in his house and is doing a show from there, because I don't think people would be very happy to see him right now.
Indeed. Now, Carla, let's move on to that long-awaited Oprah interview with Madonna. Have you got any details about that for us?
Do you know what, Gloria? I think people here are practically already buying the popcorn ready for the Big O's interview with Madonna. Now, it's already been recorded and it's going to be aired here tomorrow, but we've got a rough idea of what she said from the audience members who were in that show. They said that she was very emotional, on the verge of tears, when she was talking about the accusations levelled at her that she adopted this 13-month-old baby, basically just for a publicity stunt. Now, a lot of the controversy involves the fact that the baby's father has now come out and said that he never intended to give his baby away. He didn't actually think he was giving him up for adoption. He wasn't aware of the full facts. Madonna has now come out and said, well, you know what? The father looked very happy about the adoption, very pleased. And in the whole year that the baby's been in the orphanage, not one member of the family has visited him. Another twist is that according to Malawian law, international adoptions are illegal. Now, she's being attacked for using her status, for who she is, to sway that law. She says she did nothing wrong, but she did say that they more or less made up the laws as they went along. But the plot thickens, Glo, because we know that later this week, a group of human rights people are going to go to a Malawian judge and ask him to review this case. So, I mean, a lot going on here. Madonna clearly tried to do something very good, and it's backfired in many ways spectacularly, but I'll get all the clips for you tomorrow morning, I guess.
Looking forward to that, Carla. Pretty in pink, looking lovely. Take care.
Baby talk, there's a little else here, for reasons which will soon become clear.
And so for the north of England and North Wales... GMTV
weather, sponsored by Nestlé Cereals. Whole grain for the whole family, every morning.
Hello, good morning. Now, there's a fair amount of cloud around, as you can see on the overnight satellite picture. It's been streaming its way in from the south and west, and it's going to be bringing with it more in the way of rain. I think all of us had better brace ourselves for a fairly wet day. If it's not raining where you are now, it will be at some point later. You can see the rain that's been nudging into the south and west. If we add on the rest of the graphics, you can see that there's also some rain across parts of Scotland, and it's generally quite a cloudy start to the day for the bulk of the United Kingdom. As I say, even if it's not raining where you are just yet. Now, what we will see for this afternoon is the heaviest of the rain continuing to move its way northwards and eastwards. So it'll march its way up across most of the country. The heaviest of those outbreaks of rain is always going to be out to the west, but I think even across eastern areas it'll be fairly grey. We're also going to be seeing some fairly heavy rain too across the borders region, as that area of rain from the south mixes with the rain from the north. Put that together, it just means lots and lots of it. So it's going to be a fairly dismal afternoon, I think, for Northern Ireland, as I say, the borders region of Scotland. But even further north than that, skies are going to remain fairly grey and it will be wet. Now, temperature-wise for today, it's a fairly mixed bag. As you can see, they're starting to turn cooler and fresher already across Scotland, not even getting up into double figures. 8 or 9 is going to be the best that you can see here, perhaps getting into around the mid-teens further south, but we've got some fairly breezy conditions as well, so it may not feel like it, again, especially if you get caught out in all that rain. So this is what we've got in store then for the rest of the week. It's going to remain fairly breezy, fairly wet across most parts of the country, as you can see. For Thursday, that rain will remain across more northern areas, especially across the north and east. Some sunshine, I think, for more southern counties, especially for the south and east. And then for Friday, it's really more of the same. Temperatures are going to remain pretty much as they are at the moment. For Saturday and Sunday, it looks like Sunday is going to be the better day of the weekend, in as much as you'll see a little bit more glimpses of sunshine. It's not necessarily going to be wall-to-wall stuff, but you will see the odd glimpse of it. But it's still going to remain fairly breezy and temperatures, as I say, up to around the mid-teens. Here's your summary.
Find out what's in store for the next 5 days on our website, gm.tv.
Good morning. The time is 6:29 on Wednesday, the 25th of October, 2006.
Yes, you're watching the News Hour on GMTV. In the next half hour, it's still a struggle at the CSA. New figures show the agency is showing little sign of improvement despite more staff. We'll be talking to one campaigner in a few minutes' time.
And we'll be meeting the twins who gave their mum a bit of a surprise by being born different colours. Yes, they'll be here in about 20 minutes. But first, support for the Labour Party has dropped to its lowest level for almost 20 years, according to a poll out this morning. Just 29% of voters say they now back Labour, and the majority cite the government's record on health as its biggest failing. Well, Sue Jameson is at Westminster for us. Sue, what more can you tell us?
Well, Gloria, I think Tony Blair's waking up this morning a bit worried about his figure. 29% as opposed to the Tories, 39%, the Lib Dems on 22. Now, this is a similar figure to one in 1987, just before Margaret Thatcher got in for the third time. And he'd be particularly worried because it's about the NHS. And three out of four people say that despite the massive investment, and after all, Labour has doubled the amount they put into the NHS since 1997, despite that, a lot of that money has not been well spent. And only one out of four people think the NHS has actually improved. It's all part of more pressure, really. A lot of Labour MPs already unhappy that Tony Blair hasn't yet said when he's leaving and he might leave office in May next year. They think that with figures like this, you probably need a new start. So it's a bit more pressure on the Prime Minister.
And Sue, the NHS is not the only headache for the government this morning, is it?
No, more like a migraine, really, with the CSA. Yes, these are half-yearly figures for the clear-up rate of the whole backlog of new cases for the CSA. Now, the government had said, we are going to reduce that by 25% from May this year to May next year. Well, those half-yearly figures are out, and they're at 9%. So the Tories are saying, well, this is pretty shambolic. Despite having 1,000 more staff in, the government's strategy here is clearly not working. The Department for Work and Pensions says these are only half-yearly figures. We're going to do a lot better in the next half because new training and new equipment will then kick in. So we'll have to wait a little bit longer to see if they manage to hit that 25 squarely on the nose.
Sue, thanks very much for talking about the CSA shortly.
Let's catch up on the rest of the news. Here's Amanda.
John, thank you. Good morning. Drivers of gas-guzzling vehicles could be penalised for damaging the environment. Under the plan, drivers of the most polluting cars could be charged almost £500 to park outside their own homes. Well, Rachel Harrison is in Richmond in Surrey, where the scheme is under consideration. Good morning to you, Rachel. These really are tough measures, aren't they?
Yes, good morning. Well, it's a bold step, but certainly carbon emissions and climate change are of real concern. And this will be the first council in the country, if this scheme gets the go-ahead, to actually penalise those gas-guzzling motorists. But I can assure you, if it works, it'll be up and down the country before you know it. So what's the plan? Well, the Liberal Democrats are proposing that if you own a 4x4 or one of the larger cars, like a Jaguar or a BMW, you will see your parking permit rise from £100 to £300. Then, added to the fact, if you are a two-car household, you'll see your bill go up by another 50%. Putting the total bill to £750. However, if you're the owner of a hybrid car or a car with low emissions, like perhaps a smart car, you'll see perhaps a discounted rate and may even be able to park for free. Now, Green campaigners are of course saying that this is a great idea. They say we'll see emissions drop by around 15%, but if you're the owner of this vehicle this morning, you're not going to be too happy about it.
Rachel, many thanks. Doctors at a North London hospital will find out today if they'll be allowed to carry out controversial surgery to perform full face transplants. Jonathan Swain is outside the Royal Free Hospital. Good morning, Jonathan. No easy decision, this.
Amanda, there's just so many issues that they've got to consider. Doctors here at the hospital say that they're capable of carrying out Britain's first full facial transplant, but the debate really goes far wider than just whether it can be done. There's the big question really is the moral question about whether it should be done. It's only 10 months ago that surgeons in France carried out a partial facial transplant on Isabelle Dinois, 38-year-old, who's attacked by a dog. Now, doctors here say they have four potential patients who are badly disfigured that could benefit from this revolutionary treatment. But really, the ethics committee, who will decide later today whether they should give the go-ahead, have been agonising for months now over various issues. They've got to decide the impact on the donor's family. They've also got to consider things like whether the patient's body will actually accept somebody else's skin tissue. And they've also got to understand and accept and analyse, really, whether the patient themselves is actually mentally strong enough to cope with having a new identity. These are very big issues that they've been confronted with, big issues which could have a big impact on the medical world in future, Amanda.
Jonathan, thank you. Young women at high risk of breast cancer are to receive better screening. The National Institute for Health and Clinical Excellence has recommended that more women are given MRI scans to help them target the disease in the early stages. Here's Sally Rourke.
For women who live in fear of breast cancer, it's welcome news. NICE have given the go-ahead for some as young as 20 to have MRI scans.
they can detect breast cancer at a very early stage, where prompt diagnosis and treatment offers the best chances of survival.
Until now, women at risk could have mammograms, but they've not always helped. Breast tissue in younger women tends to be dense, and MRI scans, which are more sensitive, are better at detecting tumours. But still, only some will benefit.
Around 5% of breast cancers are diagnosed in women with a strong family history of the disease. Some of them will be entitled to MRI screening.
They cost around 10 times more than a mammogram. But for those they do save, they're a price worth paying.
Now, if you're a celebrity hoping to avoid recognition on a glitzy night out, then what better way than to wear a mask? Actress Scarlett Johansson did just that, along with Jerry Hall, Lizzie Jagger and supermodels Erin O'Connor and Gisele Bündchen. They were at the birthday party of society photographer Nick Knight. Kate Moss and Pete Doherty were also spotted in the karaoke room. The time is now at 6:36. I'm back at 7 with our next news update. Here's John and Gloria.
Thanks, Amanda. Competition time now. Kevin Adams is in Las Vegas.
Yes, if you want to hit the jackpot and win £10,000, here's how.
GMTV are giving you the chance to win £10,000 flash cash, courtesy of bold 2-in-1 crushed silk and jasmine. You can spend it on whatever you like, whether it's a holiday of a lifetime or just paying off some bills. And here's the question you need to answer. Las Vegas is famously known for having many A. lakes, B. ski slopes, C. casinos.
You can dial 09068 100 100. That's 09068 100 100. Or you can text A, B or C as your answer, plus your name and full address to 81149. Or you can enter via the website.
Lines close as usual at 9 o'clock, so if you're interested, get dialing.
Now it's time to find out what's happening where you are.
Good morning and welcome to the breakfast news from ITV Granada. First, a Stockport man will appear in court in Wrexham today, charged with the abduction of a 15-year-old girl in North Wales. The teenager was discovered in Bangor on Friday, 15 hours after she disappeared in Wrexham. 49-year-old Alan Grant is accused of kidnap, assault and two serious sexual offences. An investigation is underway after a light aircraft crashed near to the runway at Liverpool Airport, injuring two people. The Cessna went down just before 6 o'clock last night whilst attempting to land. The men on board were taken to Whiston Hospital with head, facial and back injuries. Paramedics say they're lucky to be alive. Pensioners from across the region are lobbying Parliament to demand the government acknowledge the needs of older people. William Moore, who's a member of the Merseyside Pensioners Association, is just one of a thousand who are expected to travel to London. One of his key concerns is the government's recent white paper on pensions, which he believes fails to address the scale of pensioner poverty.
How can a government introduce a new pension scheme, a pension scheme which is supposed to take care of all the problems that we've had in the past in the pensions industry, and not award anything at all, nothing at all, to existing pensioners? Doesn't make sense.
Talks are being held today over the future of 260 workers whose jobs have been axed at the sports car TVR's Blackpool plant. Union leaders, town hall bosses and management at the Bispham site will meet today to discuss their options. A buyout by workers hasn't been ruled out after the firm decided to shift production to Europe. Sport now, and there was good news last night for Everton in the Carling Cup third round as they beat Luton 4-0. Meanwhile tonight, Blackburn, Bolton and Liverpool are all in action, and there's an all-northwest tie at Gresty Road as League One crew take on Premiership leaders Manchester United. There, Alan Smith will start for the first time since breaking his leg playing against Liverpool in February.
The attitude that I've shown since I've been injured has been rewarded by the people at this club, the fans. And people from other clubs as well who've wished me well, and it's so nice that people from rival clubs appreciate as a player.
Well, that's it for now. We'll be back with you again at 7:05. Finally though, let's just take a quick look at the region's weather.
Relief for dry, chapped hands when they need it most. Nivea Hand SOS Intensive Balm.
Some early brightness, but it won't be long before the cloud thickens and rain spreads upwards from the south. This afternoon it'll be wet, heavy at times, especially in the west of the region. Top temperature 14 Celsius.
Welcome back. It's just coming up to 20 to 7. We'll take a look at the morning papers. The Independent leads on Iraq and the revelation by one of their most senior, well, the United States' most senior generals yesterday. They appear to have some plan for a general withdrawal from Iraq within 12 to 18 months. Times leads on the announcement yesterday by John Reid about Bulgarians and Romanians and the restrictions that were placed upon them, and the £1,000 instant fine for those who flout the law, although they admit it would be very difficult to police. And Daily Telegraph, Labour signals the return of the O level. That's an indication that we may return to a system of schooling and examination abandoned when GCSEs replaced O levels 18 years ago. What have you got?
Quick look at the tabloids, the Daily Mail. Council snoopers get right to enter your home. There's to be a revaluation of all homes in England, and the Mail says that council inspectors will have the right to enter your home. The Sun, well, yesterday, Lady Heather Mills-McCartney said that she would be taking legal action against some of the newspapers today. The Sun seems to be fighting back, saying that Kate Moss would give evidence against Heather. And more heartwarming stuff from Richard Hammond's exclusive interview in the Daily Mirror, saying that he does hope to be behind the wheel again within weeks.
OK, new figures show the Child Support Agency is still failing single mums right across the country. £3.5 billion remains uncollected, and despite being bolstered with 1,000 more employees, the agency still isn't on track to meet its own targets, or the government's targets anyway, of tackling new claims. Alison Davis, founder of the Child Support Action Group, she joins us from Cheshire, and David Laws of the Lib Dems is alongside me here in the studio. Alison, thanks very much indeed for getting up to talk to us. The indications are it's still as bad as ever, really, isn't it?
Yes, it is. And it's appalling that they have not reached their targets that the government have set. An awful lot of money has been spent, and they are still making huge mistakes.
Yes, indeed. And you know that. You've got 70,000 hits on your website, I hear.
Oh, yes. And people still have trouble. They're making new applications this year, and 5 months after they apply, they haven't heard anything. It is absolutely appalling. The CSA remain an arrogant organisation who are just not listening.
Well, David Laws, you've been saying much the same thing for some time now. In fairness to the CSA, there's a 9% reduction in the number of new backlog claims, isn't there? So they're making some progress, although they're well short of their target of 25%.
Their problem is they've still got 250,000 claims that they haven't even processed, and the average age of those is now almost 500 days. So if you get caught in the backlog, it's taking, you know, towards 2 years to clear your case. And so that's a big worry.
This despite 1,000 more staff?
This is in spite of more staff and the announcement in July that they were going to replace the agency. Two big problems. A, we don't know what they're going to replace the agency with. They haven't even announced that yet. And B, we're beginning to hear that they're thinking of writing off a huge portion of the arrears.
Well, I read £1 billion. They're going to write off £1 billion.
I think that they could well write off £1 billion or more of money that people have been waiting for years and years. Now, you can understand that if the absent parent has died or something, but many of these cases are nothing like that. They're simply cases where the CSA has failed to collect the money over a long period of time, and now the government is trying to wash their hands of it.
But again, come back to you, Alison, in fairness to the CSA, who get a lot of stick, and we ought to remember that there are thousands of people who do get paid and do get what they're owed. But the second point I was going to make to you, Alison, is that you've got to remember that we're chasing errant parents here. I mean, people, largely men, but not exclusively men, who are just failing to meet their responsibilities and hand over cash, for whatever reason, to their former partners for the upkeep of their children.
No, the CSA always have that as their excuse. They have got all the facilities they need to track down parents. But may I refer to what David Laws has just said? If they write off all this debt, are they going to compensate people for the money they have not received due to CSA's mistake? If you're a parent with care waiting for money and have been waiting for a number of years and the CSA come along and say, sorry, we're not going to pay, how can they do that? They are creating child poverty in this country.
Well, is there any indication there'll be compensation, David? Not that it's your responsibility.
There's no sign of that yet. I think the fear always is with governments that they try to get away with as little as they can. But I think that there will be, as Alison said, outrage if people who have waited years and years just to have their cases processed suddenly discover that these arrears are written off.
But in fairness, again, I keep saying in fairness, it's not the government and it's not the agency that's defaulting, is it? It's the missing parent who's defaulting.
In fairness, there are two points. One is you still wouldn't expect the CSA to take 500 days to process a case. I mean, that's before they even start to enforce it. And secondly, they are, and I've seen this in my own constituency, often very incompetent in tracking down absent parents, even when they're given the address details and the address of the employer. They just don't seem to have been a competent agency.
And at the end of the day, Alison, what we're talking about is mums largely, but dads as well in some cases, who are suffering real hardship here, aren't we?
Oh, yes. And money is everything. Children need money. I think the CSA, they've just removed themselves from reality, but they're not listening. I know lawyers who are advising them now, and they're not listening. They are arrogant, and you can't keep removing them from the responsibility. They were set up to do this job, and they're not doing it.
Last word from you, David Law. We've got Gordon Brown on at 7:30. What's your message to him this morning?
I think my message to Gordon Brown is that if he wants to run the country, which he seems to be aspiring to at the present time, he's got to show that his government can run the Child Support Agency and the tax credit system, both of which we talk about on a regular basis and both of which haven't been fixed for very many years.
Both of which are very much in his department.
That's right.
David, thanks very much indeed. Alison, good to see you again. Thank you very much indeed for talking to us.
The time now is 6:46. And new research has uncovered that one in five people in the workplace have been the victim of some form of bullying or harassment over the past 2 years. It's also revealed that women are more likely to be bullied than men, as Marcella Whittingdale reports.
Unfair criticism, ridicule and even physical harassment. Bullying in the workplace is on the increase. A new survey shows that one in five employees say they've been bullied in the last 2 years. Those most likely to become victims of bullying are women, black and Asian employees and disabled workers, with women twice as likely to be bullied at work than men, and a third of those from ethnic groups reporting some form of harassment. The report says bosses need to stay alert to signs of bullying. It also highlights how bullies don't always recognise what they're doing and that victims can be reluctant to complain.
And we're joined now by Lynn Witheridge, who is the chief executive of the Andrea Adams Trust, and Ruth Johnston, who herself was bullied at work. Ruth and Lynn, thank you for joining us. Ruth, I want to start with you. You were working as a midwife.
Yes.
Give us some examples of the kind of bullying you were subjected to.
Quite insidious to start with, not being given information, having my office taken away, memos sent out saying that my management duties were being cut and being changed without me even being notified before things happened, being excluded from information.
And how long did that last?
It was over a 4-year period.
And when did you think, actually, there's something wrong here, I need to speak out about this?
After about the 4 years, my health was beginning to suffer. I was losing confidence. I was getting very anxious about getting to work when my boss was on duty. It was very difficult, and I dreaded phone calls from her, whereas when she wasn't there, there was no problem. And I thought, well, this can't be right. Is it me who's failing? Am I no good at my job? Or what is it? And it was when I spoke to my son that he said, look, you ought to get in touch with the Andrea Adams Trust.
Right.
And that's when I acknowledged that it wasn't me who was at fault. With Lynn's help, I realised that it was something that shouldn't have been happening.
Mm. And what would, if you could give one piece of advice to any viewer who is suffering from bullying or harassment in the workplace, what would it be?
Just get advice. Yes. Get your friends around you. Just believe in yourself. Remember what you were like before it happened. And Lynn, the advice is brilliant, yes.
Well, thank you for coming in, Lynn. Now, we know that you're more likely to be bullied if you are female, disabled, black or Asian. Do we have a profile for the kind of people that are bullies?
We're all bullies. But because the word takes us back to our childhood, the connotations of the word is very emotive. We refuse to believe that we are capable of bullying. But this is a prehistoric behaviour in us all. We love power, and as individuals, sometimes we abuse that power in the workplace.
But isn't that a bit defeatist? Doesn't that mean that we'll always have bullying?
We will always have bullying, yes, because it's prehistoric behaviour. It's inherent in us all. What we can do is learn how to deal with it in the workplace, but we can never eradicate it.
And what are the most common forms of bullying that you come across in the workplace?
Bullying is a psychological abuse. It isn't like a physical abuse that you can spot straight away, and it's tiny pieces of jigsaws. If I said to you, the way that you're looking at me makes me feel intimidated, you think, oh, come on. But if you carried on with persistent behaviours like that, I'd soon find out that there is a jigsaw that shows me that you're trying to abuse your power over me in some way.
And what would be your advice to any of our viewers who are suffering from bullying?
Take it seriously. Don't be ashamed of it. When you're being bullied in the workplace, it's usually because you're a threat to somebody. Somebody perceives you as a threat. So do something about it and talk openly about the subject.
OK, and there is a Ban Bullying Day coming up, isn't there?
Yes, a national day on the 7th of November for everybody to get involved.
Well, really interesting to talk to you both. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Indeed. You're watching the NewsHour on GMTV. This morning's headlines. Support for the Labour Party has dropped to its lowest level for almost 20 years. Just 29% of voters say they now back Labour. Following an operation in France last year, doctors at a North London hospital will find out today if they're allowed to carry out controversial surgery to perform full face transplants. And actress Scarlett Johansson joined a bevy of supermodels and celebrities at a masked ball in London last night to celebrate the birthday of society photographer Nick Knight.
Now then, all babies are special, but the two we're about to meet are a million to one miracle. Meet Leighton and Caden Richardson, who are twin boys, but as you can see, they're anything but identical. One is black, or almost black, and one is white. Leighton and Caden are here with their mum, Kerry, and Dr. Hilary Jones, who will attempt to make some sense of this. A very good morning to you both. How are you?
I'm fine, thank you.
They look great. They're fast asleep, completely undisturbed, unperturbed by being on telly, aren't they?
They've just been fed till they're happy.
Oh, I see. How old are they now?
13 weeks.
13 weeks. Mm-hmm. Now, I've got to ask you, first and foremost, were you expecting twins?
I was told on my 12-week scan.
That was no surprise?
No.
But it must have been a surprise when you saw them?
At first, they were actually come out white, so it was about 3 or 4 weeks after they were born that Caden's colours started to change.
I see.
And Leighton started to go lighter.
Yes. So their father is white?
He is, yes.
And you are not. What's your background?
Nigerian, mixed race Nigerian, English.
Okay. So this is a gradual process?
It was, yeah.
With Caden. And is it continuing? I mean, is his skin continuing to get darker, or do you think that's it now?
No, it seems to get darker every day.
Does it?
It's every day that goes by. Yeah. It gets that little bit darker.
And what do people make of it when they see the two of them?
They're just amazed by it. I mean, a lot of people won't believe the twins. They stand there actually questioning me, whether they are twins or not, and then, like, why they're dressed the same. So you have to sort of explain that they are twins.
Yes. They're a fine pair, I must say. I love the size of them. Content as Larry. Now then, what's the science behind that? I mean, I'd imagine that in these circumstances there's some kind of fusion, but not so.
Well, there is, and sort of Kerry, being of mixed Nigerian-English heritage, will have genes for both dark skin and white skin. Mm-hmm. And what's happened here is that she's released two eggs, both of which contain a predominance of genes for one colour. Mm-hmm. So that one of her eggs contained a predominance of genes for darker skin, mm-hmm. Which is rare in itself, and vice versa for Leighton. So she's got twins, one who's going to probably get a little bit darker, mm-hmm. and Leighton is probably going to stay very white.
Now, we're very easily call things miracles or million-to-one chances, perhaps overuse the phrase, but in this circumstance, this is special.
It is very rare, and it's even more rare to have twins, where this happens. But, you know, in general practice, I see people who've got different children, and some are certainly lighter or darker than the others, with different eye colours. So, you know, they have 50% of each other's genes, but the genetics of colour is actually quite complex. There's probably 7 genes involved, but if all those genes are in one egg or in one sperm, then this will happen. Yeah. But it is exceedingly rare, and Kerry can say, hey, you know, these are extra special twins.
They look lovely. Absolutely fine. And the pictures
good,
of health and contentment.
Fantastic.
Indeed.
Yeah.
Yes. You're doing it right.
This time.
Lovely. Thanks very much indeed for coming down to you. You live in Middlesbrough, don't you?
We do, yes.
Yeah, thanks very much indeed for making that long journey. All the very best to you. And and the boys, and that's just about it from the... Oh, you're there.
Hello.
Thank you. I wonder what was on my shoulder. That's just about it. Thank you very much, indeed. That's just about it from the two of us. Kate and Ben popping in a moment for GMV Today.
And joining them, international heartthrobs, Rod Stewart and Simon Cowell, and Gordon Brown, maybe.
Indeed, yes. Whether he qualifies for that description or not, it's up for you to decide. But first of all, the weather with Andrea.
After all the pleasure they've given you this year, it's only right that you give something back.
This is such a wonderful surprise. This couldn't make us happier.
Thank you so much.
We love you.
Thank you!
The only awards show where the winners are chosen by you.
It's truly a magical night. Thank you, darling. We're so excited.
Sir Trevor McDonnell hosts television's biggest night.
Sit down, please.
The National Television Awards 2006, Wednesday at 8, ITV1.
Inside these girls is a lady just waiting to come out.
My dad is going to be so proud of me.
A journey that will become a personal battle.
Bottoms?
If they really are going to make the change.
I'm really sorry, I know I was wrong.
So which of these ladettes...
See, she liked her. She's fantastic.
...will blossom into an English rose. Ladette to Lady, Thursday at 9, ITV1.
Over the last decade, she has been at the cutting edge of fashion. Next week on GMTV, Victoria Beckham shares her style secrets.
I'm a girl's girl and I think I know how girls want to look and how they want to feel.
Fiona Phillips travels to Madrid for a GMTV special. Victoria Beckham's fashion tips next week.
And so for the north of England and North Wales... We'll have...
GMTV weather, sponsored by Nestlé Cereals. Whole grain for the whole family every morning.
Hello there, good morning. No surprises, it's October, there's a lot of cloud over us. That means we've got a... we're kind of staring down the barrel of a fairly wet, miserable day. This is the culprit, is this area of rain that's actually been moving in from the south and west overnight. You can see the rain that's been nudging in from the southwest is going to continue to push its way across England and Wales as we go through this morning. Elsewhere, we do have cloudy skies. There's not going to be that much in the way of sunshine around, as you can see, and we do have some heavy rain across parts of Scotland as well. So, put the two together. This is what's going to happen through the course of this afternoon. That rain will continue to edge in across England and Wales. I think the heaviest outbreaks of rain will always be out to the west. It'll still be fairly grey and wet across central and eastern areas, but the heaviest of that rain will be across, I think, the southwest of the country and into West Wales as well. Things slightly different as we move across Scotland. As that rain pushes its way northwards, it's going to mix with the rain that's already across Scotland. Put that together, it means heavy and prolonged spells of rain across the Borders region. That will be throughout today and also across into Northern Ireland. Rain continuing across the far north and east of Scotland. Maybe the Northern Isles. You could well be the only place see some sunshine through today, but even saying that, it doesn't necessarily mean you're going to be the warmest place. Temperatures will struggle here a touch, only getting up to around 8 or 9. Elsewhere, you could see temperatures managing to scrape up into double figures, but with the fairly keen breeze blowing and also the fact that it's so wet, it might not feel like it. So what have we got in store for the rest of the week? It looks like things are going to remain pretty much as they have been throughout this week. Rather unsettled, Scotland continuing to see some rain and rather breezy conditions. Maybe a touch more in the way of sunshine, I think, across England and Wales during the course of Thursday. Similar story really for Friday, not that much in the way of change, even in terms of temperatures. I think 16 is the best that you can hope to see here. And for the weekend, again, we will see more in the way of windy and wet conditions pushing in again across more northern areas and the south and west. Some sunshine managing to squeeze in between, and it looks like Sunday will be the better day of the weekend if you're looking that far ahead. It will still feel fairly blustery though, and temperatures pretty much as they are at the moment. AC summary.
For your local 5-day weather update, visit our website gm.tv.
Good morning. Fat chance. In an exclusive interview with GMTV, Chancellor Gordon Brown unveils his plans to fight the flab as childhood obesity rates rocket.
Costing the earth, could the owners of gas-guzzling cars soon have to pay to park outside their homes?
And Michael's mission, Michael J. Fox, showing the physical effects of Parkinson's disease, speaks out in favour of stem cell research. That's all to come this morning, Wednesday, October the 25th, 2006.
Good morning, you're watching GM TV today. It's approaching 7 o'clock. We're going to have more on those stories in the next hour.
Plus, showbiz treats galore this morning. Mr. Saturday Night himself, Simon Cowell, will be here. The UK's top soul diva, Beverly Knight, will also be joining us on the sofa. Oh, and you know, Rod Stewart's just popping in as well. That's after 8 o'clock. Not a bad lineup, really, is it, Ben?
Cracking lineup. And as well as that, we're looking into the future. Richard Gaisford will be revealing the gifts we'll each be buying for each other. Christmas 2008, as he continues his gadget-laden tour of South Korea.
But first, support for the Labour Party has dropped to its lowest level for almost 20 years, according to a poll out this morning.
Just 29% of voters say they now back Labour, and the majority cite the government's record on health as its biggest failing. Sue Jameson is at Westminster for us this morning. Sue, uncomfortable reading for Mr Blair, then.
Yeah, well, Ben, I don't suppose there are many mornings at the moment the Prime Minister thinks, oh, good, I must take a look at the papers, but I suspect this one might go on the bottom of the pile because it's showing Labour on 29%, the Tories on 39% and Lib Dems on 22%. And this is one of the worst poll results since 1987, which was just before Margaret Thatcher got in for the third time. And you're right to say health is a major issue here. 3 out of 4 people believe that the vast amount of extra money that Labour has put into the NHS, and they have, after all, doubled the budget since 1997, that a lot of that has been wasted, and only 1 in 4 people thinks that the money generally has been well spent so that the NHS is actually improving. It's a big headache for Mr Blair because, of course, there's pressure as well on him about when he's actually going to go, many feeling perhaps it would be better to do that now. And there's also another headache on the way. The CSA Child Support Agency, their half-yearly figures show they've cleared up the backlog of new cases by 9%. Their target at the moment is 25% by March next year. Back to you.
Sue, thanks very much. Drivers of gas-guzzling vehicles could be penalised for damaging the environment in a pilot scheme that may get the green light next month.
Yes, under the plan, drivers of the most polluting cars could be charged almost £500 just to park outside their homes. Rachel Harrison is in Richmond in Surrey, where the scheme is under consideration.
Yes, good morning, Kate. Well, tough measures basically to try and sort out climate change and stop the amount of carbon emissions that this country produces. And certainly, if this scheme gets the go-ahead, it'll be the first council in the country to actively penalise gas-guzzling motorists. But I can assure you that if it works, it certainly won't be the last. Others will follow suit. So how will it work? Well, the plan is this. The parking permits for anyone who has a 4x4 or a Jaguar or one of the larger cars will basically go from £100 a year to £300 a year. Then if you are a two-car household, that figure will again be increased by another 50%, putting your total bill at £750 a year. However, if you're the owner of a hybrid car or a car with low emissions, you'll get a discounted rate and in some cases park for free. The idea being that when you go to your car showroom, of course, you're going to be looking for a car that is more environmentally friendly. Now, Green campaigners are saying that this is a fantastic idea. They say emissions will go down by around 15%, which is great news for the environment, but bad news if you're driving one of these.
Thanks very much indeed, Rachel. Thank you.
We're going to get the rest of the news now. Here's Amanda.
Ben, thank you. Good morning. Doctors at a North London hospital will find out today if they'll be allowed to carry out controversial surgery to perform full face transplants. Jonathan Swain is outside the Royal Free Hospital. Jonathan, good morning to you. No easy decision this, is it?
Certainly not, Amanda. Doctors here say that medically it can be done. The big question is morally whether it should be done, because we know the techniques are already in place. It was only 10 months ago when French surgeons carried out a partial facial transplant to 38-year-old Isabelle Dinois, who was badly attacked and disfigured from an attack by a dog. Doctors here in London say they have 4 potential patients already lined up, should they be given the go-ahead by the Ethics Committee, who will make their decision and announce their decision later on today. But for months, they've had the difficult task of agonising the moral issues, things like the impact on the donor's family, who'll see their loved one's face transferred to somebody else. They'll also have to consider the impact on the patient themselves. Are they mentally strong enough to have a new identity? These are massive issues that they've got to consider. The benefits, of course, mean that people that are badly disfigured not only get a new identity, but they get a new, much improved quality of life, Amanda.
Jonathan, thank you very much. The actor Michael J. Fox has caused controversy in America by giving public support to a Democrat politician who approves of stem cell research. The actor, who has Parkinson's disease, has been accused of faking the extent of his illness after he appeared in a party political broadcast shaking visibly.
Right now, I care deeply about stem cell research. In Missouri, you can elect Claire McCaskill, who shares my hope for cures. Unfortunately, Senator Jim Talent opposes expanding stem cell research. Senator Talent even wanted to criminalize the science that gives us a chance for hope. They say all politics is local, but it's not always the case. What you do in Missouri matters to millions of Americans. Americans like me.
There's some brighter news for thousands of families facing a miserable Christmas after the collapse of the savings company Fairpack. The British Retail Consortium, which represents major high street stores, has agreed to a goodwill gesture. It'll reveal later today what it hopes to be able to offer the 150,000 Fairpack customers. And the long-awaited Dirty Dancing, the musical, opened in London's West End last night, and it's already a record breaker. Tickets have only been available for the last 6 weeks, but £12 million worth have already been sold. That makes it the fastest-selling West End musical of all time. It's been written for the stage nearly 20 years after the hit movie came to our screens. And that brings the time now to 5 minutes past seven. I'm back at half past. Now here's what's happening where you are this morning.
Good morning. Welcome to the breakfast news from ITV Granada. First, an investigation is underway after a light aircraft crashed near to the runway at Liverpool Airport, injuring two people. The Cessna went down just before 6 o'clock last night whilst attempting to land. The men on board were taken to Wiston Hospital with head, facial and back injuries. Paramedics say they're lucky to be alive. A Stockport man will appear in court in Wrexham today, charged with the abduction of a 15-year-old girl in North Wales. The teenager was discovered in Bangor on Friday, 15 hours after she disappeared in Wrexham. 49-year-old Alan Grant is accused of kidnap, assault and two serious sexual offences. Pensioners from across the region are lobbying Parliament to demand the government acknowledge the needs of older people. William Moore, who's a member of the Merseyside Pensioners Association, is just one of a thousand who are expected to travel to London. One of his key concerns is the failure to address the scale of pensioner poverty.
How can a government introduce a new pension scheme, a pension scheme which is supposed to take care of all the problems that we've had in the past in the pensions industry, and not award anything at all, nothing at all, to existing pensioners? Doesn't make sense.
Talks are being held over the future of 260 workers whose jobs have been axed at the sports car TVR's Blackpool plant. Union leaders, town hall bosses and management at the Bispham site will meet today to discuss their options. A buyout by workers hasn't been ruled out after the firm decided to shift production to Europe. On to sport now, and Everton's David Weir spent the night in hospital after being knocked unconscious during their side's 4-0 win over Luton in the Carling Cup. Having undergone tests, the Blues skipper's injuries aren't thought to be serious. Meanwhile tonight, Blackburn, Bolton and Liverpool are all in action, and there's an all-Northwest tie as Crewe take on Premiership leaders Manchester United. There, Alan Smith will start for the first time since breaking his leg, playing against Liverpool in February.
The attitude that I've shown since I've been injured has been rewarded by the people at this club, the fans, and people from other clubs as well who've wished me well. And it's so nice that people from rival clubs appreciate as a player.
That's it so far. There's more for you at 8:05. Finally, though, let's have a quick look at the region's weather.
Relief for dry, chapped hands when they need it most. Nivea Hand SOS Intensive Balm.
Some early brightness if you're lucky, but the cloud will thicken and rain will spread upwards from the south. This afternoon it'll be wet, at times heavy, especially in the west of the region. Top temperature, a rather mild 14 Celsius.
Hi there, good to see you this morning. Now, we were overwhelmed by your response yesterday to our item on postnatal depression. Now, here's just a selection of video phone messages that you sent us.
Hello, my name is Vanessa from Wiltshire. I have postnatal depression, which would leave me crying for days for no apparent reason.
Hi, I'm Jen from Reading. I suffered postnatal depression 9 years ago. I felt like I wanted to die, like someone would take my baby away from me. I felt so alone. I just wish people would understand and try and help rather than judge.
Well, we were also contacted by one woman from Warwick who was only diagnosed at the beginning of the week with this condition. Jackie Cavler is with her now. Good morning, Jackie.
Good morning, Kate. Yes, as you said, so many phone calls and emails from people yesterday. Really heartbreaking stories of the trauma that people have gone through. One of the ladies who called us was Shelley here. This is her husband, Tim, and her little boy, Callum. Now, Shelley actually had postnatal depression twice, and this happy family picture really does hide the awful heartbreak that she has gone through over the past couple of years. She was first diagnosed when Callum was 8 months old. She had treatment for a month and thought everything was fine. But only this week she's been diagnosed again because things basically just didn't get any better. Here they are. Here's little Callum. He's a bit intrigued by all this going on this morning. And Tim and Shelley, good morning to you. Now, Shelley, 2 years old Callum is. Most people wouldn't even think you could have postnatal depression for so long. Talk me through what it's been like for the last 2 years.
Well, I've been in a living hell. It's been absolutely, it's been a nightmare to try and function on a day-to-day basis. I'm continually weepy. I can't function with everyday tasks. I've lost my memory. I can't do the simplest of things. And it's been a very, very frightening experience.
Yeah. Yes, it has, hasn't it, Callum? It's been awful for poor mummy. I know one of the fears that many women have, and you had the same fear, you thought maybe your child would be taken away if you revealed what was going on.
I know that was one of the reasons that I didn't come forward for so long, is I thought that I would be declared in a certain capacity and my child could be taken away from me.
So traumatic. Tim, but the father's quite often forgotten in these sort of situations, but it's not easy for you either, is it? Seeing your wife going through this and maybe not really understanding it.
It is difficult from the man's side because the men don't really understand what is going on, and hence we don't know how to help. Mm. We obviously try and do our best, but sometimes our best isn't good enough.
Well, I'm sure you've done. I know you've been a rock for her. You're finally getting treatment now, and hopefully you can see the light at the end of the tunnel at last.
Yes, it's such a relief to now know what the issue is, and then we can tackle it, and there's treatment, as you know, that's available. And it's just been a long time coming. I should have done it a long time ago.
Well, I really hope it works out for you. You've got a lovely family, and you've been very good. Thank you very much, Callum. Just that one family suffering, but as we've seen, so many women around the country going through the same thing as Shelley has.
Certainly are, Jackie. Thanks very much, Ian. Do please keep your video messages on postnatal depression coming in. All you have to do is this. Just record a message, then send it to 07739 672 673. It will cost you 50 pence plus usual picture rate. You presumably need one of those video phones to do it.
Yeah, or send your messages in as well, because obviously I think one of the things that struck us was the amount of those messages that helped everybody else that was watching the programme
yesterday.
Made a really big difference. Hilary will be with us later as well. He's going to be holding a live video web chat at 9:30 if you need some advice on coping with postnatal depression. You can send him your questions again on the website gm.tv. Time is 12 minutes past 7. These are the main headlines that you're waking up to this morning. Support for the Labour Party has dropped to its lowest level for almost 20 years. Just 29% of voters say they now back Labour. Owners of gas-guzzling vehicles could be penalised under a new plan, with the drivers of the most polluting cars charged hundreds of pounds to park outside their homes. And today's weather, cloud and rain will sweep northeast across the country, bringing heavy showers at times. It'll be windy in the south, but temperatures should reach 16 Celsius in places. So there's 10 grand to give away as ever, isn't there?
Absolutely. Kevin Adams is in Las Vegas. He's got all the details.
Hello and good morning and welcome to Las Vegas. Now, I've brought you here to this tiny little coffee shop to watch me enjoying a tiny little coffee. Of course I haven't. I've brought you to the world famous Jean-Philippe Patisserie. And I'm going to tell you why it's world famous, because it boasts one of the world's largest chocolate fountains. It contains three types of chocolate, and here's the man himself, Jean-Philippe Moret.
Hi, Kevin. How
good
are you?
Morning, Jean-Philippe. Nice to meet you. Now, tell me a little bit about this chocolate fountain.
Chocolate fountain runs three kinds of chocolate, white, dark and milk. Mm-hmm. And there is 2 tons of chocolate.
2 tons of chocolate. Yeah. And that is real chocolate?
Yeah. That's real.
While I try and stop myself from putting my face in there, you check out today's £10,000 competition. GMTV are giving you the chance to win £10,000 flash cash, courtesy of bold 2-in-1 crushed silk and jasmine. You can spend it on whatever you like, whether it's a holiday of a lifetime or just paying off some bills. And here's the question you need to answer. Las Vegas is famously known for having many A. lakes, B. ski slopes, C. casinos.
You can dial 09068 100 100. That's 09068 100 100. Or you can text A, B or C as your answer, plus your name and full address to 81149. Or you can enter via the website.
Those lines close at 9. The winner's going to be revealed at the end of the show.
Now then, coming up, we've got an exclusive interview with the man who would be Prime Minister, he'd like to be. Gordon Brown's going to be here to tell us how he plans to crack down on the obesity crisis, which is blighting the lives of Britain's children.
And she'll be coming to a town near you very, very soon. This morning, Beverly Knight's with us as she prepares for her UK tour. See you then.
Techno Trends, sponsored by thebestof.co.uk. The smart way to find the best of local business.
Now, if you want to get ahead on all the latest electronics that'll be in the shops in the UK in about a year's time, you might want to consider getting yourself over to South Korea.
Oh, yes. Now, Richard Gaisford has done just that and he's been sampling the best gizmos in Seoul.
Technologies are born in South Korea that set trends for the rest of the world. Here in Seoul, they're currently showcasing some of the latest gadgets and gizmos that may still be months or years away from hitting our shores.
Well, you know, the Koreans are selling every sort of television to the world, from mobile miniature pictures on your handset that are crystal clear, to this, one of the biggest television sets on the planet. At 102 inches across, it's formidable. Every single picture is pin sharp. It's what they call full high definition. For the last few years, manufacturers have been trying to work out exactly what combination of gadgets we want in one pocket-sized device. This lot think they've done it. They've got a 6-megapixel camera there, a digital music player, and mobile TV, all in one very handy little box. If Korean designers had their way, every front room would look like this, a true cinema in your house with real special cinema sound.
Well,
let me just translate for you and tell you what she's saying. She's telling them that this is the latest in DVD technology. It's called Blu-ray. It's high-definition DVD. And if you've gone out and invested in one of these big HD-ready televisions for your home, then when these things arrive in the shop, it's what you're going to want to plug into it.
So that's what's coming soon, and this is what's available now here in South Korea.
It certainly looks like gadget heaven, and the scary thing is there's 12 more floors just like this to explore.
Prices are a little lower than at home, and the choice is amazing.
Well, this is the kind of technology I love. The idea is you stand on this wobbling and vibrating platform, you can feel it all the way through your body, shaking you about. And it's exercise without actually having to move.
Finally, my search is over. Like a child in the sweet shop, my technological taste buds have been truly satisfied.
Well, here it is, the latest and the greatest from Korea, a 10-megapixel camera phone. And look, it's even got a proper zoom built in the back as well. Well, if you've ever had a nightmare choosing a mobile phone, this place could prove a problem for you. It's just one floor of one store. And look at it, it has to be, what, 4 football pitches wide, and all it's selling is phones. Take a look, there is such a large choice, and there's so many features that we just don't see back home. What they tend to do is try things out here in Korea. If it works, well, then they'll sell it to the world.
Well, there you go. There's more on South Korea's obsession with technology on our website. More technology for you, gm.tv.
Now, I'm very excited. Multi-mobile award winner. Not only that, is she fabulous, wonderful singer. She is now an MBE as well. The gorgeous Beverly Knight joins us. Good morning.
Good morning.
And congratulations on the MBE.
Thank you. Or something.
Some way offer some sort of formal greeting.
Oh, Bev will do. That's
is that what they said when they phoned up? Bev, it's the Queen. You've got an MBE.
Well, my management phoned me and said, are you sitting down? I thought, oh, God, what now? Doom and gloom. I said, you've been recommended to get an MBE. I was like, who? What? Sorry. I was so stunned. I still I'm stunned now, even when I think about it.
Why did you get it?
It was primarily for music and for the work that I've done, you know, charitable things.
Lots of charity.
For you.
Yeah.
For you.
It's so exciting. And when is it you due to pick it up? Have you got it yet?
Well, I was supposed to get it in December. But I'm on tour, so I can't. So
you've delayed the Queen.
I've delayed the Queen.
The Queen waiting. You might find yourself in the Tower for
I know,
that.
I know. Oh,
wow.
God.
But how exciting! That's brilliant. And like you say, you've just released your greatest hits.
Yeah.
Which was fantastic. But you're going on tour again.
Off on tour again.
For heaven's sake, woman, do you ever spend any time at home?
Not really. The fridge is empty. No, it's been a busy year of touring. Went out earlier in the year with Take That, which was brilliant. Went out with Bryan Adams, which was brilliant. And now I'm off by myself touring again.
And your tour kicks off on the 9th of November.
That's right.
And you're going all over the country?
Going all over. We start in Cardiff, coming to Hammersmith, London, Hammersmith Apollo on the 29th, and finishing up in Plymouth.
Fantastic.
So, should be
great. Will the London gig kind of be like, that's your home gig, that's the one that's going to be really big down at the Apollo?
That will be the biggest in terms of just numbers and folk will be there. I mean, the one that probably has, you know, tugs at the heartstrings is Wolverhampton,
right.
Which is a few days before.
When you get home.
Yeah, that will be home.
I mean, you've done the tour that you did with Take That. Mm. It was extraordinary, the sort of the response that tour got. And I saw the boys when they were on tour in Manchester and they couldn't believe what was happening.
Yeah.
They'd had 2 days sold out at Man City Stadium. It was
That's right.
Incredible.
Incredible. I mean, from my perspective, to be supporting a group which, you know, haven't been around for 10 years, but could come back, sell loads of arenas, and then go out and sell loads of stadiums. Those kind of numbers, you can't even compute. So I think it added up to about 750,000 people in the end, which is an incredible amount of people to be performing for. And I can't imagine how those lads must have felt.
Is it true that you tried to get tickets, but they'd sold out?
Yep. By the time I got myself on the phone and, you know, thought, right, tickets, gone. So when I got the phone call, you know, it's Gary, want you to support us. I was like, one.
What a relief. Any chance I can get some tickets as well, please, Gary?
That's what I mean.
Fantastic. So you're finally going to get to do some of your own stuff on your own tour. And there's another album coming out?
Yeah.
When are we going to get that?
That will be around March time, so spring. We're looking at a new album, which I am doing right now as we speak.
So you are working on that. So you're going to get a bit of touring over Christmas.
Yeah.
Go to the palace. And then you're going to pick up, and then we're going to get the album.
That's right. So it just keeps rolling on.
It does. Well, it's good news for us because it means that you're going to be around and we'll get to see you again very shortly.
Oh, thank
Beverly,
you.
Well done. Congratulations on the MB.
Thank
really, really chuffed
very
for you.
Very much indeed.
And very much looking forward to the tour as well. Have a fantastic
thank
time.
You.
It's great to have you
I
with
shall.
Us. You can find out if Beverly is performing at a venue near you by getting onto the website. All of her dates, all of her venues are there, and it's well worth going to see her because she's awesome live. GM.TV.
We're going to check on the weather forecast for you now. Here's Andrea.
So for the north of England and north Wales... We'll have...
GMTV Weather, sponsored by Nestlé Cereals. Whole grain for the whole family every morning.
Hello there, good morning. Now, we do have a lot of cloud around across the country this morning. If we run the sequence through, what you can see is it's moving in from the south and west. That's where the rain's going to be arriving from through today. But you can also see we've got some cloud across more northern parts of Scotland. That's where we're also seeing quite a wet start to this morning. Now, let's take a look at this morning's picture. This is where, at the moment, we've got a pretty grey skies. This is where we're seeing a fair amount of rain. And this is where the bulk of the weather is going to be coming from during the course of today. Elsewhere, you saw on the satellite picture how cloudy it is. No surprises then to see that most of us are going to be waking up to a grey, if not wet, start. Now, for this afternoon, this is what's going to happen. That area of rain is going to continue to work its way across the country. The heaviest, I think, of that rain is going to be out to the west. So that means a wet afternoon for much of West Wales across the west country. Elsewhere, even if it's not raining where you are, and I don't think anyone's going to be too far away from a shower or two, it will still remain pretty grey this afternoon, I'm sorry to say. And as we move away northwards, what will happen is the rain that's moving its way up from the south will mingle with the rain that's already across the north. And that means some fairly heavy and persistent stuff across the more borders region of Scotland into northern England and across into Northern Ireland as well. The rain that's already across Scotland, not really going terribly far, as you can see across the farther Northern Highlands. Looks like the Shetland Isles. You could well be the only place to see some sunshine today. So enjoy. doesn't necessarily mean you've got the warmest of the temperatures. They will be struggling today, even to get into double figures across northern Scotland. 8 or 9 degrees is the best you can achieve here. Even further south, where temperatures are managing to get into about the mid-teens, I think because it is so breezy and so wet, it possibly won't feel like it. Now then, this is what you've got in store for the next couple of days. Basically, it's more of the same, really. Might be coming from different directions and raining at different times of the day, but basically no one's going to be too far away from getting wet. You can see the rain across Scotland during the course of Thursday. Bits and pieces of brightness around. Again, a grey afternoon expected for Friday, and it looks like, as far as the weekend goes, Sunday may well be the better day of the two, as it's going to remain blustery and wet for many places on Saturday. Easy summary. Get a 5-day weather update for your postcode on our website, gm.tv.
28 minutes past Sweet. 7, these are the main headlines you're waking up to this morning. Support for the Labour Party has dropped to the lowest level for almost 20 years. Just 29% of voters say they now back Labour. Owners of gas-guzzling vehicles could be penalised under a new plan and charged hundreds of pounds to park outside their homes. Following an operation in France last year, doctors here will find out today if they can perform full face transplants. And Parkinson's sufferer actor Michael J. Fox has appeared in a controversial party political broadcast in America to support stem cell research.
Now, obesity in children and how to combat it is something we've talked about a lot on this programme over the years, and it's also something the Chancellor is determined to tackle, and he joins us now. We were being a bit noisy there, weren't we, during Andrea's weather forecast. We got ticked off there by the director, but it's only because we were catching up on chat and gossip. But look, it's great that you're here to talk about obesity in children, because the numbers are going up and up and up,
yes,
aren't they?
Yes, they are.
What are you going to do about it?
Well, first of all, better information about food, so that people know what to buy their children. I think, secondly, we've got to do something about television advertising before the watershed hour. And I think thirdly, most important perhaps, we've got to do something about sport and fitness. And what I'm suggesting today is that every school should be able to offer children 2 hours of sport a week. Sport should be considered not just football and rugby and all the hockey and all these things, but yoga and aerobics and everything else. We should have a broader view of sport. We should move up to 4 hours over the next few years so that people get the chance of more sport. And we should use the Olympics and the chance of people competing in the Olympics, but also the excitement of the Olympics, to get Olympic potential athletes around the schools, to get people interested in sport over the next few years. And I do think, from what I remember when I was young, that sport is incredibly important, and that will bring about greater fitness, allied to better information about diet.
Yes, exactly. It's a good package there. It's all good stuff, and I don't think anyone disagree with you. How are you going to make that happen, though? For instance, TV advertising and a ban on junk food and that sort of thing. You're talking about a voluntary ban at the moment. Isn't it in your power to make it a ban?
Well, we said we'll look at that in 2007, but Ofcom, which is the body that looks at this, will report in the next few days about what they want to happen on television advertising. But that's only part of it, you know, because I think parents, like I do, I want more information about the food I'm buying.
Where would
from
they get that from? What are you suggesting they do?
Labelling of food that you buy in the shops and the superstores. And there is a debate between the different companies about how they label the food at the moment. But I would prefer better information about what's good and what's nutritious and what's good for the diet. And I think most parents would, and I think we ought to do that better as well.
How can you, I mean, how can you make that happen, though? I mean, you'd prefer it, I prefer it. Can you not go and say to the food manufacturing companies, do this now, I'm the Chancellor?
You can. We're trying to get a voluntary agreement, though. And some stores have gone for one system, others have gone for another system. We've got to get that right, because you don't want people to be confused.
No. But given that... So you want to work with them in an ideal
way. Yeah, but given that there's more information in schools, given that Jamie Oliver's made this important sort of step forward on school meals, given also that domestic science lessons are going to be in primary schools, and it's going to be an option in secondary schools, not just for girls but for boys as well. So there's going to be a lot more information about the food you eat. And of course, fitness is becoming so much more important to people, and you see it. I was in Australia a few months ago, and they are so keen on sport now and fitness, and we've got to have the same, I think. Kelly Holmes is doing a great job as the school's advisor, but we could do a lot more.
Now, one of the things that, of course, Australia has is a lot more space. A lot of schools don't have playing fields now because you'd have sold them off.
Yeah, for the first time for many years, the number of playing fields is going up again. And we have tried to make it very, very difficult to sell off school playing fields.
Could you buy them back?
Yeah, we're trying to add to them. We've got a budget of about $1.5 billion for sports, including what's coming from lottery. And that will help build more playing fields. I've been talking to some of the private companies in the country about how we can go into partnership, that they could put some money in as well as the government, because a company that's operating in a particular town, it should do more to help the sports facilities develop. And I think more contact with local sports clubs will help the schools as well. So there's a lot going on, but I think 2012 is a good sort of target. By 2012, let us be the fittest nation in the world.
Wouldn't that be a good thing? Funny enough, Tim Lamb, Chief Executive of Central Council for Physical Recreation, huge title, but he's talking about he's talking about the Olympics. I know you hold that up as a beacon, and many people are hoping that's going to encourage people. He says, though, however, that's not going to do a lot of good for grassroots sport, because the money's going into the big Olympics and not helping those like you and I that might go down to the gym and want to take part in sport.
Well, I was at the Schools Olympics, the School Sports Olympics, and I met a swimmer who was training 3 hours in the morning and 2 hours in the evening. And she said, you can either come and see me swim on Saturday or you can come and see me in the Olympics. And that's the level of ambition amongst some young people. Now, does that encourage other young people? I think so. And I think the Olympics...
And will the money be there for facilities?
Yeah, well, we've put £1.5 billion into school-related sports activities. So that's not just for Olympic athletes. That's coaches that are going around better playing fields. That's more time to do fitness work. Now, I think it's starting to change, but we could do a lot better. So I want to set bigger targets, more ambitious targets. Every school, 2 hours sport. By 2010, 4 hours sport. And I think that would be a sort of real change.
It would, and you want it to be competitive as well. And for a long time, people have been saying, is this, are you turning into a competitive dad? Is this poor little John is going to be, we might let off, he's only 4 or 5 months old, but you're going to start pushing him to do well on the rugby field or something?
But I think all of us, when we remember back to our school days, I mean, there were competitive sports with other schools, and I played in the Scottish school championships and so on and so forth. I think competitive sports are a good thing. I think it tests people, it makes people better, it makes people challenged, and I think if schools have all a sports day and then they have competitions in leagues with other schools, I think that's really good.
Yeah. Now look, on the front page of the Guardian this morning, there's something that won't seem good to you, I'm sure. It's that Labour is supported at the lowest level, 29%. It's a poll they've conducted, lowest since 1987, that kind of time. So this must be distressing to you, particularly as it seems that it's health that they're concerned about. And of course, you've allocated so much money to health.
Yeah, and we're going to do better on health. Look, we have this target that nobody should wait more than 18 weeks from going to the doctor to being seen in a hospital to get an operation.
Why is it not getting through that? Why do you believe that support is so low for Labour?
Because we've had a lot of problems in the health service sorting out the changes. Some nurses have lost their jobs. That's very unfortunate. I think we can deal with that over the next few months. More money is going to go in next year, about an extra $6 billion. Some hospitals have got to improve and get up to the level of the best, but there is huge change taking place, and that is sometimes disruptive. But more money will go into the health service. It will be backed by better reforms for the future. We will meet our targets for the future. And I think then people will see in 2007 and 2008 that the money that we've spent on the health service has been for a good purpose. People are getting their operations quicker, that you can go in now into a hospital and have your operation in a day and leave, and that's a lot better. Some GP surgeries are doing operations, and we've just got to show, as I think we can, that the more operations, the cancer targets, the heart disease targets, these are now being met.
Okay. Do you think it's been affected by the fact there is some confusion over who's going to be leader of the Labour Party after Tony Blair? Would you like to see something definite on that? Presumably you, I would imagine. But would you like to see that move forward and decided? Do you think that's affecting the way people feel?
I think at the end of the day, you know, and Tony could be here or I could be here, that people vote on the policies. If you're doing things right and the economy's doing well, the health service is getting better, your schools are getting better, you're doing more to help young kids get into school sports and everything else, then people will respond. But obviously, we have got to show we're doing that all the time. We've always got to be doing things better. It's a discipline on us to be better and more effective and to listen to people. We've got to listen to what people are saying.
Okay, and how are the boys? Are they good?
Doing very well.
Are they? Keeping you lively? Keeping you on your toes?
Keeping you lively. That's what's keeping me fit.
I bet it is.
Sometimes you don't need to go to the gym to get fit.
And you were telling us that John has decided what James should be called, and it's not James.
Well, he wants the baby called Fraser, yes. And he's just made up his mind.
He won't allow it to be called James. Right, so you can sort out our money, but you can't control the boys and what they should be called.
Right.
Brilliant.
No, he'll be telling me what's in the budget next.
Exactly.
Take care.
Good to see you, guys.
Great to see you.
Thanks very much. So to come this morning, good guy or bad guy, you decide. Simon Cowell joins us here in the studio in a couple of minutes' time. First, though, if you want to make your home burglar-proof, here's reformed thief Michael Fraser with some great tips.
Doors and locks are the most important line of defence against burglary. Get them right and you'll be safe as houses. Burglars love doors with glass in them. It's easier to tell when there's no one about. As a former burglar, I advise on a solid front door, no glass, 3 good hinges and 2 good quality locks. I like a combination of a cylinder lock and a deadlock. And do me a favour, don't leave the keys in or anywhere near it. That just gives the crafty fisher the opportunity to practice his angling skills through your letterbox. And give all your exterior doors the same treatment. There's no point in being like Fort Knox at the front and open all hours at the back. Fit key-operated window locks, ideally ones that are visible to the outside. Remember, your average burglar is looking for a soft touch, so don't hide your security measures, flaunt them.
Safe as houses with firekills.gov.uk. A working smoke alarm saves lives. Push the button, not your luck.
Now, our next guest is one of the most influential men in the music industry, currently spending Saturday nights on our screen. Simon Cowell has held the deciding vote in both X Factor live shows so far and chose to boot out two of Louis Walsh's groups, The Unconventionals and For Sure. Let's have a look.
Unconventionals, I liked your first audition, thought you were diabolical tonight. Therefore, the artist who I have to send home is The Unconventionals. The artist I am going to send home is For Sure.
Oh, the power in your hands.
I love that moment.
Do you?
Yeah, I love it. Yeah, yeah.
Now, were they really the worst acts, those two?
Were they the worst? No. These Scottish boys each week have been the worst. But there's kind of a reason to vote for them. I felt with the group that went last week, For Sure, there was no reason to vote for them. It wasn't great, it wasn't terrible. The Unconventionals, who Louis really liked week one, were absolutely appalling. So I was quite happy to see the back of them.
So you're not just being nasty to Louis then? That's just an added extra?
No, it's just an added bonus, exactly, yeah. Yeah.
Is it as good a year as ever before, do you think? Because it sometimes astonishes me that there is still that much undiscovered great talent out there. Now we've had so many different shows, obviously the X Factor being the best, many different of these talent shows. It's amazing there's still people who haven't heard before.
That's well, good. You know what, I always say, it doesn't matter how many people turn up, you've only got to find one. You know, you're never going to find 10 great people. I don't do that on any of the shows, whether they're here or America. If you're lucky, you get two or three good ones. And this year, we've got two or three good ones, which is enough for me.
Yeah. Do you know who they are? Do you know who you'd like to see win?
The front runners for me at the moment are Ashley, Ben, Leona.
Well, it's exciting. It's always good to watch. We love X Factor and it's great fun. Do you sometimes, in a sense, enjoy the early bits more? I sometimes get addicted to the early bits. When it comes to the live shows, I kind of want to skip forward to who's won.
It all depends who's in the show. You know, the early rounds are fun to watch. You've got to create a sense of competition. You've got to sometimes change things week by week. Something's going to happen on the show this Saturday, which no one knows about, which is going to shock a lot of the contestants.
Oh.
And they won't know till Saturday.
Oh, OK. That's a good, exciting thing to look forward to.
Yeah.
And you're still as into this sort of music as you ever were before, because we keep hearing that maybe you're into more choral, classical music. You love Angelus, It's Your Bad. We've had them on the show, actually. They were beautiful.
Thank you. I like anything that sells.
And you think this stuff is going to sell better?
Yeah, I mean, look, Shane is an example who won the show last year.
Your lovely boys and girls are Angelus are singing. It is a beautiful
They are
band,
fantastic,
isn't it?
These kids.
Yeah, it is.
Yeah, yeah.
It's lovely.
I like these kids because it's refreshing and they're talented and it's different. I can't bear when everything sounds the same at the moment.
But then some people would say that it's kind of shows like this that makes everything sound the same. It's that kind of produced pop that makes everything all homogenous and the same.
Well, you know, we don't put that many records out from the show anymore in terms of the artists. Shane, he has now, I think he's had a number one record in about 15 countries. So you're always looking to find a star.
So what was life like for you when you were a young lad? Because your dad was in the record business, wasn't he? And your mum was a dancer. So was it, there was a feeling of entertainment and music at home?
Yes, Kate, we would put on a musical every night.
There's no business like. Was it like that at the home with the cows?
No. it was a bit show busy. My next door neighbour was the boss of a big film studio, so he would have Elizabeth Taylor, Richard Burton, Robert Mitchum.
Well, that's not a bit show busy.
Who I think my mum flirted with one night. She was caught going over a fence or something. Yeah, truthfully. I kind of grew up in that. So I think that's what made me want to go into show business when I was younger.
Yes, OK, all right. Well, you're going to come back and do a bit more show business for us a bit later on. Don't go away. We'll chat a bit more to you on GMTV this morning.
Excellent. Well, Simon's going to stick around. He's going to be back with us later on. Right now, though, it is 14 minutes to 8. Let's get the headlines you're waking up to this morning. Support for the Labour Party has dropped to its lowest level for almost 20 years. Owners of gas-guzzling vehicles could be penalised under a new plan, with drivers of the most polluting cars charged hundreds of pounds to park outside their own homes. And today's weather, cloud and rain will sweep north-east across the UK today, bringing heavy showers at times. It will be windy in the south, but temperatures should reach 16 degrees Celsius in certain places. We're off for a break now. Polly's going to be back with the cream of crop of tonight's televiewing, including how this woman's shopping addiction got her into £64,000 worth of debt.
Good grief. But first, if you want to win £10,000, Kevin Adams has a question that you need to answer.
Las Vegas is famously known for having many A. lakes, B. ski slopes, C. casinos.
You can dial 09068 100 100. That's 09068 100 100. Or you can text A, B or C as your answer, plus your name and full address to 81149. Or you can enter via the website.
TV Pick of the Day is sponsored by Lotus Thirst Pockets with technology.
Polly's here with tonight's top telly. How you doing, Mrs?
She's top TV pundit.
I'm grilling you. I think you know what's happening in the X Factor.
Yes, Simon Cowell was just talking on the show to say that there's something big changes.
Huge.
To X Factor on Saturday night. It's going to be really exciting to shake the whole thing up. Do you know?
He does know.
We've got two shows for the first time in the series, so there's going to be a hammock show on ITV2, like the main show, then our show, then the results show.
A hammock show.
That's the only thing I've... I don't get told these things, for heaven's sake.
No, look me in the eyes. He
don't
knows.
Believe him.
I barely know what day it is, let alone
would
what we're going to be doing.
Would you buy a used car from that man? Don't take TV information.
I'm from Essex. I could sell anybody anything.
Yes, that's the problem. That's the problem. So he's not telling Polly. I'm sorry.
Right, I might throw the question back when he's least expecting it and then blurt it out. Tenor going on. Right, your money or your wife?
Right.
No, I have not turned into a highwayman. It's the name of a new show tonight. This is about couples who are being ripped apart by financial trouble.
Oh.
Now, this first lady, her husband's actually a bank manager, so he prides himself on keeping a tight rein. He thinks she's got absolutely no debt at all. Here's the truth.
Oh.
I've got a credit card which I owe £7,000, a store card which I owe £4,000, a personal reserve account which I owe £4,000, a loan which I owe £35,000, another loan I owe £14,000, another loan I'm not sure how much for, and I've also got a car loan of about £5,000.
Who's giving her those loans?
I love that. Another loan of, I don't know. How many people are going in the X Factor on Saturday?
75!
Ha! Exclusive.
So, like, they hadn't talked at all ever in their lives?
No, he's literally going to find out tonight on
He might know, mightn't he?
All right, who knows now, but... as it was filmed, that's when he found out.
I suppose he'll probably get a good rate from the bank, though, won't he, to cover it all?
I think it's a bit late for that, isn't it? It's about £1 million in debt.
Wow.
Now, it's a big night on Coronation Street tonight. Okay. Fizz is taking her scooter test.
Oh!
Now, there's a lot of stuff going on.
You have to build us up a bit more.
Well,
one of those little pushy ones?
No, like a...
Oh, a motorbike.
Yeah, not one of those foot ones, okay. A proper one. But there's a lot of big storylines.
But you still don't have to take a scooter test.
Well, are you saying Coronation Street's wrong?
No. Obviously, it's a big engine on the bike or something like that.
Normal scooters, little mopedy scooters,
moped,
I think, are exempt.
Moped.
They're exempt, though,
not
I think.
Not a moped, though.
Do you know what? Should we have a look? Should we have a look at the clip?
Here's a clip, here's a bike, supportive family, chips. Let's have a look.
Hey, hey, look, there's Chris.
Oh, she must be that nervous poor thing.
Hey, hey!
Hey!
Don't be a girl!
Go away!
You stupid girl!
Are you all right?
Have you got a contract out on me or summered? Only it's not the first time you've tried to mow me down.
Bet you didn't succeed then, eh?
Like the Nicole Richie glasses.
I know.
Very trendy. Very nice.
But there's a lot of big storylines going on in Corrie, so it's nice to have a little bit of light
fun
relief
as well. Okay.
Will she pass?
Something
I'm not
over.
Telling. Yeah, yeah.
You can't hold whether she passes or not as big a secret as the changes to X Factor that Ben's holding here.
What are those changes again? I've forgotten. You
big
did
night,
say.
Saturday night. Big night Saturday night. I didn't even know Paula Abdul was coming down to be one of the judges. I really genuinely don't know what's happening on Saturday.
They leave you out a bit, don't they?
They do, yeah.
You're not part of the
Very similar
crowd.
To this.
Yes.
Not a girl, so I'm not part of the gang.
Yeah, whatever. Emmerdale.
Now, tonight, the situation with Emily comes to a huge climax. Not going to spoil it, so here's a clip of Laurel getting a little too involved.
No, it was me. I was trying to help Emily.
What, to do what? Abduct a kid that's not even hers? I'll tell you something, Laurel. You should have taken Sedate and I'd come looking for you.
Laurel meant well.
Oh, give it a rest. She's an interfering nomad and you're no better.
She obviously came round here to try and make things right, but if all she got were you jumping up and down...
If you don't get her out of here now...
Laurel, please.
We'd better go.
No, why?
Listen,
why
listen,
we...
listen, because this isn't helping anyone. Not Andy, not Emily, and most of all, not Sarah.
If you do find her, tell her next time she'll have the coppers to deal with.
Oh, my goodness. Polly, thank you very much indeed.
That's all right. Just a final thing in the script, and Ben says what is happening in the X Factor on Saturday.
Well, we're out of time. Look, Andrew's here with the weather. Thanks, Polly.
And so for the north of England and North Wales...
GMTV Weather, sponsored by Nestlé Cereals. Whole grain for the whole family every morning.
Hello there, good morning. Now, quite a cloudy picture across the UK. As you can see, it's coming in from the south and west. If we run the sequence through, you can see the direction that this cloud is moving in from. We've also got some cloud that's already across Scotland. That's bringing some rain across that part of the world. But really, I think the heaviest of the rain through today, at least to start off the day, will be across the south and west. Now, for the rest of the country, this is what you've got in store for this morning. Doesn't look too fantastic, does it? Grey skies pretty much everywhere. It looks like the Northern Isles could well be the only place it manages to see some form of sunshine through today, so I hope you enjoy it. For this afternoon, things gradually changing. What we will see is that area of cloud and rain moving its way northwards. The heaviest of it will always be out to the west, so that's western parts of Wales across the West Country. Although things may well improve across the south and the southeast, I don't think you're going to necessarily see much in the way of sunshine. It'll still remain grey, but hopefully the worst of the rain should ease away. As I say, it's working its way northwards, so it'll nudge through the Midlands up into northern England, and there it'll merge with the rain that's already across Scotland for this morning. So that means we could see some heavy outbreaks across Northern Ireland and across into the Borders region. The rain remaining really for the far north and northeast of Scotland. Again, the Shetland Islands managing to escape, so you could well, as I say, be the only place to see some form of sunshine through today. But it doesn't mean that you're going to be the warmest place. Temperatures struggling a bit here. As you can see, only getting up to around 8 or 9 degrees across northern Scotland, maybe getting into double figures elsewhere. Further south, well, you could manage to make it into the mid-teens, but because it is still fairly breezy and there is so much rain around, it possibly won't feel like it. Now, for the next couple of days or so, remaining unsettled, I have to say, for Scotland. Bits and pieces of sunshine elsewhere, so it will be a better day tomorrow than the kind of weather that we've got in store for today. Kind of similar on Friday, at least for England and Wales, and we will still see a fair amount of rain, I'm sorry to say, for Scotland. Scotland really not seeing a good week this week. It will remain that way on Saturday. It looks like Sunday is going to be the better day of the two in terms of the weekend. A little bit more in the way of sunshine around. Here's your summary. Find out what's in store for the next 5 days on our website, gm.tv.
Bank battle as the customer rebellion over charges gathers pace. The man who represents all our big banks is here to face the flak.
That chance, the Chancellor Gordon Brown tells us exclusively how he plans to fight childhood obesity.
And Twin Credible, we'll be meeting the mom in a million who gave birth to black and white twins. That's all to come on Wednesday, the 25th of October, 2006. Good morning to you. It's coming up to 8 o'clock. You're watching GMTV today. We're going to have more on all those stories in the next half hour.
Yeah, but with you till 9.25 this morning. We've got a fantastic showbiz lineup for you. Rod the Mod goes rock and roll. The legend that is Rod Stewart is with us this morning as he releases an album full of classic covers. Talking to him in about 20 minutes' time, and he's performing for us too.
And Simon Cowell will be back on the sofa to talk The X Factor and why he's venturing into the world of skincare. Extraordinary.
More about that later on. But first, Gordon Brown has told GMTV he's planning to tackle childhood obesity head-on and stem what's being described as a mass health crisis.
Now, it comes as a new polls reveal that support for Labour is at a 20-year low, with the majority of voters citing the NHS as the government's biggest failing. Sue Jameson is at Westminster. Sue, uncomfortable reading for Mr Blair this morning.
Yeah, I think you could say it was sort of the political equivalent of a very bad hair day. We've got Labour on 29, Conservatives on 39, Lib Dems on 22%, which is the worst figure. It was a similar figure 20 years ago, just before Margaret Thatcher was elected for the third time. And it's particularly worrying because it's the NHS that people are focusing on here. Labour has actually doubled the amount of money they put into the NHS since 1997, and yet three out of four people say they believe a lot.
That is sometimes disruptive.
Now, Gordon Brown was also talking on GMTV this morning about an initiative he's launching today to tackle childhood obesity. 1 million children are either overweight or obese, and he says he's got a three-point plan.
First of all, better information about food so that people know what to buy their children. I think, secondly, we've got to do something about television advertising before the watershed hour. And I think, thirdly, most important, perhaps, we've got to do something about sport and fitness. And what I'm suggesting today is that every school should be able to offer children 2 hours of sport a week.
So Gordon Brown and probably Tony Blair too prefer to talk about childhood obesity than the polls today. Back to you.
Thanks, Sue. Thanks very much indeed. Now, drivers of gas-guzzling vehicles could be penalised for damaging the environment in a pilot scheme that may get the green light next month.
Under the plan, the drivers of the most polluting cars could be charged almost £500 to park outside their own homes. Rachel Harrison is in Richmond in Surrey, where the scheme is under consideration. Rachel, tell us more.
Yes, good morning. Well, it's all about carbon emissions and concern about climate change, which is why Richmond will be the first council in the country, if this scheme gets the go-ahead, to actually change the way in which they run their parking permits. It'll work like this. The plan is that if you have a 4x4 or a Jaguar or one of the larger cars, your permit will go up from £100 to £300 a year. Added that to the fact that if you have two cars, your bill will increase by another 50% on top, taking the total average bill to £750 a year. That's not good news, not for them anyway, but it is good news if you have a hybrid car or a car with lower emissions, something like a smart car, because they'll get a discounted rate and they may even be able to park for free. Now, the idea being, of course, is that when you go to choose your car in the car showroom, you'll think twice about what you buy. Green campaigners are saying this is fantastic news. They believe it'll cut emissions by around 15%. But unfortunately, if you're the driver of either that car this morning or this one by the side of me, it's not good news.
No, Rachel, thank you very much.
Let's get the rest of the news you're waking up to now. Here's Amanda.
Kate, thank you. Good morning. Doctors at a North London hospital will find out today if they'll be allowed to carry out controversial surgery to perform full face transplants. Well, Jonathan Swain is outside the Royal Free Hospital. Good morning to you, Jonathan. No easy decision this, is it?
Well, Amanda, doctors here say medically the operation can be carried out, but the big question is, morally, should it be carried out? We know that the techniques already work. It was only 10 months ago when French surgeons carried out a partial face transplant on 38-year-old Isabelle Dinois, who was badly disfigured after being attacked by a dog. Now, doctors here at the Royal Free are very keen to carry out Britain's first full facial transplants. They say they already have four potential patients already lined up. Should they be given the go-ahead? Well, later on today, the Ethics Committee will announce their decision as to whether these operations should be given the go-ahead. But they've had a very difficult task over the last few months, agonising over the moral issues. They've had to consider things like whether morally it's right for the impact it'll have on the donor's family, who'll see their loved one's face being transferred to a new person. Also have to consider the impact on the patient themselves. Are they mentally strong enough to cope with having a new identity? These are big issues, but there's also big benefits as well, because people who are badly disfigured get the chance of having a new face, a new identity, and therefore a new life, Amanda.
Jonathan, thank you. The actor Michael J. Fox has caused controversy in America by giving public support to a Democratic politician who approves of stem cell research. The actor, who has Parkinson's disease, has been accused of exaggerating his own illness after he appeared in a party political broadcast shaking visibly.
As you might know, I care deeply about stem cell research. In Missouri, you can elect Claire McCaskill, who shares my hope for cures. Unfortunately, Senator Jim Talent opposes expanding stem cell research. Senator Talent even wanted to criminalize the science that gives us a chance for hope. They say all politics is local, but It's not always the case. What you do in Missouri matters to millions of Americans. Americans like me.
Women who give birth late in life risk having infertile daughters. Researchers claim the decline in fertility in older women can cause genetic damage, which may be passed on to female children. The age of the father apparently has no impact. Doctors now hope to extend the initial study of 74 women. Children are being urged to wear fluorescent clothing to and from school to prevent deaths and accidents on our roads.
When it's not light, wear something bright.
It's part of the government's Be Safe, Be Seen campaign to encourage youngsters to be as visible as possible as the nights draw in. Now, if you're a celebrity hoping to avoid recognition on a glitzy night out, what better way than to wear a mask? Kate Moss and Pete Doherty were among the stars who took advantage of the dress code at the birthday bash of the Society photographer Nick Knight. Marcella Whittingdale was also there.
Scarlett Johansson was just one of the stars that dazzled at the champagne-fueled party last night, along with Jerry Hall, Lizzie Jagger and supermodels Erin O'Connor and Giselle.
It's pretty exciting to come to a masquerade ball. We were trying to get to seat there something. We're like, we're blind a little bit.
Oh, it's quite easy to wear, unbelievably. Yeah, I'm sure it'll sort of get a bit wrecked later on.
Along with all the other celebrities here tonight, Kate Moss and Pete Doherty were also spotted in the karaoke room of all places before they were whisked off in a super sparkling cab. Sadly, Pete didn't rate as a headline act for ex-Mirror editor Piers Morgan.
Kate Moss discovered I was here. And I was listening to her boyfriend, Pete, what's his name? Doherty, yeah. Singing karaoke downstairs. And she saw me and had me removed by security, which was a blessed relief because I have never heard singing like that in my life.
But the rest of the stars stayed to party on into the night.
7 minutes past 8 is the time. That's it from me this morning. Here's Kate and Ben.
Thanks very much, Amanda. Now then, you've been sending us your text messages and emails all morning about postnatal depression, which is the topic that we're talking about this evening. And some really interesting calls. Mike in Gloucester says, I'm so pleased you're highlighting this issue. My ex-wife suffered from it when our son was born. She was found on the edge of a cliff about to push him off, but was stopped in time. People need to understand this is a medical condition.
My best friend suffered from postnatal depression, says Sarah, but it kept it a secret because she was so ashamed. Sadly, she committed suicide. I'm so glad you're talking about this condition because it completely engulfed her. So many terribly sad stories are sending through to us, and also ones of people saying they've heard us talking about it, they feel happy, they know now where to go and get help. We are going to return to this later on this morning, but do keep your thoughts on postnatal depression coming in, please.
Yeah, Zara's saying, I had 6 months of counselling, which has done wonders for me. It can sort it out for you as well. So do keep them coming in, 8189gm.tv.
Let's talk about bank charges and those of you who are fighting against them. That's coming up after we found out what's happening where you are.
Good morning and welcome to the Breakfast News from ITV Granada. First, an investigation is underway after a light aircraft crashed near to the runway at Liverpool Airport, injuring two people. The Cessna went down just before 6 o'clock last night whilst attempting to land. The men on board were taken to Wiston Hospital with head, facial and back injuries. Paramedics say they're lucky to be alive. A Stockport man will appear in court in Wrexham today, charged with the abduction of a 15-year-old girl in North Wales. The teenager was discovered in Bangor on Friday, 15 hours after she disappeared in Wrexham. 49-year-old Alan Grant is accused of kidnap, assault and two serious sexual offences. Pensioners from across the region are lobbying Parliament to demand the government acknowledge the needs of older people. William Moore, who's a member of the Merseyside Pensioners Association, is just one of 1,000 who are expected to travel to London. One of his key concerns is the failure to address the scale of pensioner poverty.
How can a government introduce a new pension scheme, a pension scheme which is supposed to take care of all the problems that we've had in the past in the pensions industry, and not award anything at all, nothing at all, to existing pensioners? Doesn't make sense.
Talks are being held over the future of 260 workers whose jobs have been axed at the sports car TVR's Blackpool plant. Union leaders, town hall bosses and management at the Bispham site will meet today to discuss their options. A buyout by workers hasn't been ruled out after the firm decided to shift production to Europe. On to sport now, and Everton's David Weir spent the night in hospital after being knocked unconscious during their side's 4-0 win over Luton in the Carling Cup. Having undergone tests, the Blues skipper's injuries aren't thought to be serious. Meanwhile, tonight Blackburn, Bolton and Liverpool are all in action, and there's a northwest tie as Crewe take on Premiership leaders Manchester United. There, Alan Smith will start for the first time since breaking his leg playing against Liverpool in February.
The attitude that I've shown since I've been injured has been rewarded by the people at this club, the fans, and people from other clubs as well who've wished me well. And it's so nice that people from rival clubs appreciate as a player.
And that's it for now. We'll be back with you again at around 10 past 11 this morning. Time now, though, for a quick check on the region's weather.
Relief for dry, chapped hands when they need it most. Nivea Hand SOS Intensive Balm.
Some early brightness, but becoming cloudy and rainy throughout the day with a top temperature of just 14 Celsius.
Hi there. Now then, bank charges are obviously a big source of anger to many of you and many of us. Our story yesterday of Hilary Baker, who took on two high street banks over penalty charges and won, prompted a rush of emails and phone calls. In a moment, we're going to be talking to the man who heads up the British Bankers Association. But first, though, here's some of what you had to say.
I've had my student account for a year and a half, and I've been charged over £1,000 in default charges. They just want to take your money and give it to the fat cat at the top.
My bank mishandled a transaction on my account, and that caused my account to go overdrawn by just £10. In just 3 days, they applied £750 of charges to my account.
I've had over £1,350 worth of charges in the last 4 months, and had to take a loan out to cover these charges. This was just after one mistake. I don't mind paying a little towards the charges, but I feel this is just highway robbery.
And that's very much what a lot of you feel as well. Now, the Chief Executive of the British Bankers Association, Ian Mullen, is here, as well as financial expert Jasmine Birtles. Thanks very much for coming in this morning.
Good morning.
A lot of angry people out there, Ian. I'm sure you can understand why.
Yes, but it is the case that if someone inadvertently goes overdrawn, then if they speak to their bank, then these charges are usually refunded.
Oh, clearly, that's supposed to be the case, but that doesn't seem to happen. That second call we had there, as the lady said, the bank mishandled the charges, a transaction, which meant it was the bank's fault that she went £10 overdrawn. Within 3 days, they'd charged £750 in terms of charges. Now, that's extortion. That's an extraordinary amount of money. How can they possibly qualify that as being fair?
Well, one has to see the underlying case and why this might have happened. But it does, on the face of it, sound as if something has gone wrong there. And they should have complained to the bank and make sure that that this is handled. And if it's not properly handled, then do speak to us at the British Bankers Association.
I think one of the frustrating things, Ian, is why should we have to do the complaining? Why should we put in this position in the first place? The way I understand it, you're supposed to pass on the costs of what it costs you to chase someone who's gone overdrawn. An automatic letter to say you're overdrawn doesn't cost £25. It can't possibly cost £25 to send out, but that tends to be the basic charge.
Yeah, but it's not the cost of the letter. It's the cost of making the judgment as to whether to pay the amount that is being requested and is overdrawn. That is a credit decision that is required there and costs money.
The third of those callers said, I don't mind paying, if I've gone overdrawn, I don't mind paying some of those charges as long as they're charges that I feel are fair.
Yes.
And this is one of the problems. How can they balance the cost or the charges that they're sending out? How do they qualify how much it's worth them charging?
Right. Well, charging is an individual thing for each bank. It's a competitive issue. And of course, there will be difference in the bank, the charges that each bank will make. One thing that people need to do is, if they're not satisfied with their bank, then change banks. It's very easy to shift banks.
I think one of the things, Jasmine, that we were talking about yesterday as well was suddenly we need to start understanding that banks necessarily aren't your friends. Banks are a business, they are competitive, and they're looking to try and make as much money as possible.
Yeah, very much so. And I think this is the problem that a lot of consumers have. The banks at the moment, the top five banks, are right at the top of the FTSE 100. They're making phenomenal amounts of money. Just in the first 6 months of this year, the top five banks made £20 billion, which is more than so many small countries. You know, the gross domestic product of so many small countries put together. And they are businesses, and we do expect them to make profits, but we would like to have something given back to the consumer. So it's not just the shareholders that are given money, that it's actually customers. And I think the point about these charges, yes, there's a little bit of a decision, but really these are automated letters, and people can get charged, well, up to £35 per day for just being a little bit overdrawn. And you know, we have all sorts of difficulties that are put in the consumer's way. It takes 3 to 5 days for a cheque to clear still. It still takes 3 to 5 days quite often even for a bank transfer to clear. That's going to change next year thanks to the Office of Fair Trading. But you know, you can often be in the situation where you need to get money into your account to pay a direct debit. It takes 3 to 5 days for that money to clear, and because of that a direct debit is bounced back. You get charged £35 for that, you get charged £35 for being overdrawn, you get charged
another
20.
Multiplies.
And it adds up very quickly.
Ian, why are, of all the cases we hear,
I just go back on one or two things that's
okay,
been said?
Okay, we're about the type of time though.
Okay. Well, as far as the checks are concerned, the banks don't make that money. That money is for the person who is actually sent out the check.
So why does it take 3 days to clear a check?
Exactly. 5 days. You've got the 5 days where why nobody's making money except the banks.
Because you can actually do a transaction if you pay.
It's the check who's making that money, not the banks. Mm.
No, but if you write a cheque, it true. But if you
thank you,
if you write a cheque, the money does come out of your account before it gets into the other person's account. And
but,
also,
but
with
you have the advantage of the float. There is this view that the banks are making money on the float. They don't.
Why does it take so long to clear then? Why can't it just go in and clear?
Particularly the bank transfer, because the moment you press that button, the money's gone out, and it takes 3 to 5 days to get into somebody else's.
Where does the money go?
Yeah. The money is credited to the account, or continues to be sit in the account of the person
but
who has written the check.
When I go and check my money after I've organised a bank transfer, I had to do this recently, it said it had gone out of my account, and yet the person still hadn't received it. And when we both contacted individually our bank, they said, it's because it's 3 days. So at some point that's left my account, it hasn't gone into the other person's account, where is it?
Yeah. No, it doesn't sit in the ether and the bank making the money. The actual value of that still accrues to you, the person who's written the check.
Okay.
So there's no float benefit.
All right, Ian, can I just say that?
And you would agree that that is the case.
With checks, but not bank transfers.
Well, with bank transfers.
Which is why it's changing.
All right, obviously there's some issues.
And we are changing that. And it wasn't the OFT, it's the banks themselves who have made that change.
Ian, can I ask, we've been hearing lots of cases and we've had people come in and they're taking banks to the small claims courts, they're getting their money back because they're going up. Why, and even though the banks say you've got to pay these charges, they say I'm not paying these charges, they go to small claims, why are none of the banks going to the courts to actually stand up and face the charges that these people are bringing against them? Why are none of them turning up, and why are they finding out 6 months down the line, okay, you can have all your charges back? Why are they doing that?
Well, it's pretty expensive for the banks to actually try and defend one of these cases in the courts, and I would imagine that they're doing it simply from a commercial viewpoint.
What, in terms of if they stand up and they lose, then that's going to set the benchmark.
There's the cost of doing it. Also, that we are cooperating with the OFT at the moment. I mean, they and ourselves are the experts discussing this issue together. So much better that is allowed to run its course.
It gives the impression, though, that it's indefensible, that you don't have a case to argue.
That's why no one goes to court.
That's the impression people get.
The point is that it's the OFT who has dominion, shall we say, over this particular issue, and it's they whom we are in full discussion with. So better that runs its course.
I am intrigued. Unfortunately, we're out of time, but there's a simple point that if you go a little bit, you can't pay your gas bill. The gas don't cut you off immediately. Yes. They phone you up and they say, what's going on? Can we try and help you out? If you miss a payment in your bank, you start getting charged money as soon as you go, and within 3 days, 750 quid.
Yeah, but the vast majority of people who manage their account properly really do have the best deal in the world from the British banks.
Okay, I'm not sure that they'd all agree with you. Unfortunately, we're completely out of time, but Jasmine and Ian, thank you very much for coming in this morning. I'm sure lots of you will have lots to say about that. There's plenty of useful information about dealing with bank charges and other money matters on the website gm.tv, and do let us know what you thought. 81189 gm.tv is the website and the email address.
Thanks very much indeed. Thank you. Now, still to come this morning, Rod Stewart. Yes, the legend that is Rod the Mod. He's here to talk to us in a few minutes. We'll be talking to him about his new album, his newborn babe, and That could be Penny Oil as a boy, couldn't it? And his wedding plans as well.
And Kevin Adams is amid the bright lights of Vegas. He's got £10,000 to give you before the end of the show. That should pay off a few bank charges. See you in a bit.
Hi there, let's bring you up to date with the main headlines you're waking up to this morning. Now, support for the Labour Party has dropped to its lowest level for almost 20 years. Just 29% of voters say they now back Labour. Owners of gas-guzzling vehicles could be penalised under a new plan, with drivers of the most polluting cars charged hundreds of pounds to park outside their homes. And today's weather, cloud and rain will sweep northeast across the UK today, bringing heavy showers at times. It'll be windy in the south, with temperatures reaching 16 degrees Celsius in some places.
We're going to be talking to Rod Stewart very shortly, but first, here's Kevin Adams with £10,000 to give away.
We're in the money. We're in the money.
Good morning and welcome to Las Vegas. Guess where I am? I'm floating on the Bellagio Lake. You know where the water cannons come out? Look at that. That is firing at 40%. £10,000 will make it fire at 100%. GMTV are giving you the chance to win £10,000 flash cash, courtesy of Bold 2-in-1 Crushed Silk and Jasmine. You can spend it on whatever you like, whether it's a holiday of a lifetime or just paying off some bills. And here's the question you need to answer. Las Vegas is famously known for having many... A, lakes. B, ski slopes. C, casinos.
You can dial 09068 100 100. That's 09068 100 100. Or you can text A, B or C as your answer, plus your name and full address to 81149. Or you can enter via the website.
Good luck, get dialing, remember lines close at 9 o'clock and one of you could be walking away with £10,000 by the end of the show. But there's more good news. Ocean's 13 was filmed on this very spot. George Clooney stood here, Brad Pitt stood here. Which one do you like? George Clooney, Brad Pitt, George Clooney, Brad Pitt, or just me? Not me? No, oh, see you later.
Now, Rod...
Wow.
I overexcited him with my volume. Rod Stewart's here. I'm not even going to bother introducing you. I was going to say that you're not Rod the Mod anymore. You're Rod the Rocker. Well, you've always been
Rod the Dad.
You're Rod the Dad. You're the whole thing encompassed, but you've got this new album out.
Yeah.
Which is already number one in America.
Yes, indeed.
And I'm sure he's going to be number one here. And it's all rock.
Yeah, it is. It's a welcome return from doing all the standards, which I've done for the last four albums. They were amazingly successful. So this was a bit of a, once again, taking a bit of a chance going back to rock and roll. But it seems to have paid off.
Because your Great American Songbook album did so well.
I just said that.
Oh, did you? Can we start again?
No, we've got to start again. This is funny.
Okay. Now, look, it's called Still the Same. Mm. Does it feel the same? Is it as good? Is it as much fun as it was in the 60s and 70s?
Well, it's different. Obviously, the older you get, everything changes, your perspectives change. You know, I've got six kids now, or seven I should say, so everything's changed. I don't go as mad as I used to, but I still enjoy getting up and singing in front of a live audience. I really do love it.
And the buzz is still there when you're out there, is it? There you go, there you are doing your stuff there, looking great. And it still feels as good as it ever
Yes, indeed it does, yeah.
Yeah, brilliant stuff. And I was interested, you were on X Factor, weren't you, on Saturday?
Yes, Kate, I was.
You can tell me how well I'm doing as we go along. I can tell you're mocking me slightly.
You're not blushing.
Which
yet.
Is fair enough. I am blushing, which you should blush, shouldn't you, for having the mickey taken out of me. But you're on X Factor on Saturday night. And I think a lot of people we talk to who've got the pedigree of kind of rock that you have behind you and success you have, are kind of sometimes a bit scathing about those sort of shows because they seem to pluck people from obscurity and thrust them there. But you obviously think it's a good thing. I mean, did you think when you saw these kids that they were talented and as good?
I don't do scathing, you know. I refuse to on this show because, you know, I got turned down by every record company when I first started and I know what it's like to be rejected. But I think it's okay as long as they somewhere along the line do their apprenticeship like I did. I might be old-fashioned, but, you know, I sung in pubs and clubs for 6 years before Maggie May came out, you know. And it really hones you in on your art, you know. You become a better performer. So I think they need to do that.
Does it make you appreciate it in a different way?
Oh, God, yeah. Yeah, when you eventually break through and make it, like I did with Maggie May in 71, you think, oh, thank goodness, you know, I was proved right that I had faith in myself. And
yeah, and you got there in it.
You're doing well, Kate.
Thank you very much. You give me marks out of 10 as we go along. So, you know, when you see them, people performing on that show, though, I often wonder whether they're really into the music maybe as much as you are, because the music is there for you all the way through.
Yeah, but you've got to remember, they're told what to sing. Mm. I mean, there was a great R&B band on there. They didn't really want to do You're In My Heart. In fact, they got voted off. And I felt for them, but as I said, you know, you've got to learn to try and sing every form of music to be an accomplished singer. I think so, anyway. Yeah.
Now, are you going to pass all this on to your various children, including your little one? Because when you were on the show last time, you were on with Lorraine, weren't you? And you started singing before we even knew it was Alice. So let's have a look at this.
Slow lie the fields of Athenry.
Me babies like that, shush.
Now, you see, did that work? Has he already got a bit of a musical flair about it?
Well, he's a Celtic supporter, because that's a well-known Celtic song. But it's too early to say. If he wants to go into music like all my other kids, you know, I'm right behind him, whatever makes him happy.
Yes, exactly. And how are you getting on? Is it good being a dad at this stage of life?
Yeah, it is, because I choose and make more time for him, you know, than I did for the other kids, because I was chasing the wild dollar when I was a lot younger, and therefore didn't have that much time for my kids as I should have done. And by God, am I paying for it now.
Do they make you pay
that? Oh, yes. Not financially, but they do put me under a bit of pressure sometimes. But they're a good bunch of kids. They've all stayed the right side of the law-ish.
And sometimes, you know, when you see your youngsters going through all the pressures, I often think it's interesting when what we do as kids ourselves, we don't necessarily want our own children to do it.
Yeah, exactly. Well, you did it, Dad. What can I do it? You know, that is always the double-edged sword of being a parent, especially one who's, you know, doesn't have the life I've had, you know, and still doing it, I may add.
Well, exactly. And some. We may explore that later. Now, Penny, you're going to make an Honest Woman of her next year, I hear now.
Yeah, next year. I can't tell you where or when for obvious reasons, but
Presumably I'll be getting the details on the invite.
Oh, yes, darling, we'll send you an invite. She's actually doing the invitations. I'm doing the music and the beer and the wine.
Yeah,
that's all I'm doing.
Are you being told what to wear?
No, she wants me to wear a kilt, but my right knee's been playing me up, so I may not.
Hey, I tell you what, Tartan's back, and so is Animal Print. Mm. So I hear you're going on tour. Might we see you in those lovely leopard skin leggings again?
No, I don't think so. Not at the ripe old age of 61. My kids have nicked all that stuff. My two daughters were in Vanity Fair last month wearing all my old stage costumes.
I saw that, actually. It was great to see. Yeah, it's great to see. They look good.
Very glamorous.
Very glamorous. Very glamorous to see.
So proud of them.
Okay, well, you're going to perform a bit later on.
I will, Kate.
Still the same. Please, thank you. Well, now I've told you two, you've got to. It's great to see you.
Thank you. Thank you, Kate. That was a good interview Kate did there.
Thank you very much indeed.
It's at the end of the show now,
Kate. It's the end of the show. You can go now.
See you later, then.
It's one of your bests. She did all right, didn't she? Oh, we're going to get the weather. Here's Andrea.
GMTV weather, sponsored by Nestle Cereals. Whole grain for the whole family every morning.
Hello there, good morning. Now we've got some rain moving in from the south and west through today. It's going to be moving its way northwards as we go through this morning. As you can see, it's going to be a grey day for just about everybody. The only place really that's going to see maybe even a glimmer of sunshine is going to be the Shetland Isles in Scotland. Everyone else, if it's not raining where you are just yet, brace yourself because it will do at some point through today. Now you can see that we do have this rain moving its way northwards. The heaviest of it will always be out to the west. So that's western parts of Wales and the southwest. What we'll also see is that rain moving northwards, merging with the rain that's already in Scotland. So we could see some heavy rain too across Northern Ireland and the Borders region. Really, there may well improve a touch across the south and east, but even here, I think skies are going to remain fairly grey. Temperatures, well, pretty varied across the country today. Single figures across the far north of Scotland will feel quite chilly here. Across more southern regions, you could get into double figures, but it might not feel quite as warm as a chart suggests. Remaining unsettled, I have to say, for the next couple of days and, sorry to say, through to the weekend as well.
OK.
That's rubbish.
I know.
Sort it out.
Yeah.
OK. All right. Still to come this morning, the really shocking extent of bullying at work. We're going to be revealing that. It's a whole new survey, but they're looking at ways to stamp it out as well.
Interesting stuff. But first, if you're worried about house fires, why not get your local fire brigade to come to your house and give you fire safety advice absolutely
free? Firemen in the house?
You'd love that, wouldn't you?
I would love that, yeah.
Where have we started? Here's Matt Scott.
Come on over, firemen.
If you take the proper precautions, then hopefully I'll never have to pay you a visit like this. Almost half of all house fires happen at night, so make sure you get into a regular routine at bedtime. Check candles and cigarettes are fully extinguished, and switch off at the mains anything that doesn't need to be left on. 60% of fires start in the kitchen, followed by the living room. So shut these doors at night. Simply closing a door could give you up to an extra 20 minutes to escape in the event of a fire. Plan how you'd escape if there was a fire, and keep the route clear. If you do have a fire, please don't attempt to tackle it yourself. Get everybody together, get out, stay out, and call us on 999.
Safe as houses with firekills.gov.uk. A working smoke alarm saves lives. Push the button, not your luck.
Hi there, welcome back. We're with you until 9:25 and still to come this morning. Why the baby blues is not just about babies. We're going to be talking to one woman diagnosed with postnatal depression this week. That's more than 2 years after the birth of her son. We've got lots of help advice for all of you out there that's been phoning and texting and emailing this morning on how to beat this really debilitating condition in a few minutes' time.
As well as that, Rod Stewart's coming back to perform a rock classic from his new album, and Simon Cowell's going to be back on the sofa again for another chat about X Factor and all things in the world of the cow.
Yes, that is a big deal, the world of the cow. Oh, yes. And Michael J. Fox is at the centre of a row after appearing on a political advert, shaking and looking not good with the effects of Parkinson's disease. And we'll tell you about the row surrounding that a bit later on.
Time is 20 minutes to nine. And first of all, though, we're going to be talking about bullying at work because new research has uncovered the fact that one in five people in the workplace has been the victim of some sort of bullying or harassment.
Unfair criticism, ridicule, and even physical harassment. Bullying in the workplace is on the increase. A new survey shows that one in five employees say they've been bullied in the last 2 years. Those most likely to become victims of bullying are women, black and Asian employees, and disabled workers, with women twice as likely to be bullied at work than men, and a third of those from ethnic groups reporting some form of harassment. The report says bosses need to stay alert to signs of bullying. It also highlights how bullies don't always recognise what they're doing and that victims can be reluctant to complain.
Well, we're joined by Lynn Witheridge, who is the chief executive of the Andrea Adams Trust, and Ruth Johnston, who was bullied herself at work. Thanks very much for coming in this morning. Ruth, I've come to you first. Just tell us what was happening to you.
Well, it started quite insidiously. I raised a point about staffing with my boss, and she didn't like me criticising
challenging
her. And she tended then to exclude me from memos, exclude me from meetings, pile on the work. She took away my office, she took away my filing cabinet, and basically wanted to demote me. She sent memos out to everybody saying that my managerial duties were being taken away from me, even before I knew anything about it. And so it just builds up gradually, and from being a confident person, you begin to believe that you are this useless person in the workplace.
Did anybody around you, anybody that was senior to your boss, actually say, what's going on with you? You seem to be a different person. Did anyone notice there was something happening?
People noticed the amount of work I was having to do, and they noticed that I was getting more tired at work, but the bosses themselves, they just ignored what was going on, really.
Which I think can often be the problem, is people don't think it's actually as big an issue as it clearly
was.
And mentally, how were you feeling?
You don't sleep, you get anxious. When my boss worked part-time, and the days that she was at work, I used to dread going into work. I used to dread the phone ringing because it would be her at the end of it, whereas other times I could just get on with things normally. And in the end, I had to go off sick.
Yeah. So how did you eventually sort this problem out?
Well, I tried to sort it out internally, but that took such a long time. And my son, who had had contact with the Andrew Adams Trust, well, with Lynn, he said, look, have a word with Lynn. And I contacted Lynn, and she believed in me. She believed that what was happening to me was bullying, and she just supported me through the whole process of challenging my boss.
Lynn, your charity, clearly it must have been an immense relief for Ruth to find out that she wasn't making it up, it was actually happening, and that you believed her. So I suppose, and seeing as that's what your charity does, these figures don't come as a surprise to you?
No, not really, but it's surprising that women seem to be much more predominantly the targets of bullying.
And why is that?
I don't think that's really the truth. Because of the childish connotations of the word, if you use the word bully, as adults we say, no, we're not being bullied. It's strong management, it's a personality clash. Men don't like to say we're being bullied because of the image that maybe they could be seen as being weak or a troublemaker. So men are less likely to come forward and put their hands up and say, hey, hang on, something's going on. I think you're trying to bully me. They try to bury it.
But also there's a situation, I've certainly been in this position, where you kind of don't want to make a fuss because you don't want people to think that you can't take it, or that you're making a fuss, or you're getting in the way, and just think, maybe it is me, maybe I am making this up.
Absolutely. As Ruth rightly said, bullying creeps up on you long before you know what's happening to you. You've been bullied. So recognition and awareness of this subject is absolutely essential, because it isn't physical violence that we're looking at. It's a brutal form of almost psychological intimidation.
Which is worse. Horrible. Now, I understand there's going to be a National Awareness Day, isn't there? Tell us about that.
On the 7th of November, this is our third year of raising awareness of this nationally, and for adults to say, without any fear, I'm being bullied, or I have been bullied, or becoming aware that they could be seen as being a bully themselves.
OK, so that's going to be a great day, National Awareness Day on the 7th. And everything's fine and you're much happier now?
Oh, absolutely. As soon as I faced up to the problem and gone through the process...
The weight lifts, doesn't it?
The weight lifts. It took about a year, but I'm back to what I used to be,
I think. Great, well, thank you very much. We love that. Thank you very much for coming in, both of you. There is plenty of information on the website, and the point being there is help out there for anybody that is suffering like this. Thank you very much for coming in.
Thank you.
Now, here's your chance to win £10,000. Kevin Adams has the details.
Hello and good morning and welcome to Las Vegas. Now, I've brought you here to this tiny little coffee shop to watch me enjoying a tiny little coffee. Of course I haven't. I've brought you to the world-famous Jean-Philippe Patisserie. I'm going to tell you why it's world-famous, because it boasts one of the world's largest chocolate fountains. It contains three types of chocolate, and here's the man himself, Jean-Philippe Moret.
Hi, Kevin. How are you?
Good morning, Jean-Philippe. Now, tell me a little bit about this chocolate fountain.
Chocolate fountain run three kinds of chocolate, white, dark, and milk. Mm-hmm. And there is 2 tons of chocolate.
2 tons of chocolate. Yeah. And that is real chocolate?
That's real.
While I try and stop myself from putting my face in there, you check out today's £10,000 competition. GMTV are giving you the chance to win £10,000 flash cash, courtesy of bold 2-in-1 crushed silk and jasmine. You can spend it on whatever you like, whether it's a holiday of a lifetime or just paying off some bills. And here's the question you need to answer. Las Vegas is famously known for having many A. lakes, B.
B, ski slopes. C, casinos.
You can dial 09068 100 100. That's 09068 100 100. Or you can text A, B or C as your answer, plus your name and full address to 81149. Or you can enter via the website.
Those lines will close in just under 15 minutes. Get dialing.
Now, we had a massive response to our item on postnatal depression yesterday, and many of you sent in video phone messages, it's a new world, telling us about your experiences. Here are some of them.
Hello, my name is Vanessa from Wiltshire. I have postnatal depression, which would leave me crying for days for no apparent reason.
Hi, I'm Jim from Reading. I suffered postnatal depression 9 years ago. I felt like I wanted to die, like someone would take my baby away from me. I felt so alone. I just wish people would understand and try and help rather than judge.
Well, we were also contacted by Shelley Burns O'Regan, who was only diagnosed with postnatal depression at the beginning of the week, so it's all very new to her. And Jackie Kebler is with her now. Morning, Jackie.
Good morning. Yeah, we did have so many calls, didn't we, yesterday, and emails and so on. As you said, Shelley here is one of the people who contacted us. Now, this is her with her husband Tim and little baby Callum. And actually, although you say it's new to her, this is actually the second time she's had postnatal depression. This picture looks like a very happy family picture, but in reality, life was pretty hellish for her over the past 2 years. She first was diagnosed when her baby was just 8 months old. She had a month of treatment and thought everything would be fine. But things didn't really get better. And 2 years on, this week, she is being diagnosed again. And she still has postnatal depression. Now, most people wouldn't even think that you could have it for 2 years, but Shelley is living proof of that. This is Shelley, Tim and little Callum here, being very good this morning with his stickers. Shelley, I mean, you seem really happy together and everything, but it hasn't been that good over the past years. Talk me through some of the way you've been feeling.
Well, it's been an absolute struggle just to function on a normal day-to-day basis. I haven't been able to really get out of bed in some days. I've been weepy. My life just has been out of control and I felt like I was going mad.
I bet you have. And you said even things like you couldn't even remember Callum's birth date, which is frightening.
Absolutely. And as people say, it's the most important day of your life, or one of them, and I can't remember the date. So my memory's gone. Mm. And I know people say you have nappy brain, but you're meant to get your memory back, but it just hasn't come back yet.
And I know you had one big fear, which many of the people who've contacted us had, that you were frightened that if you reveal this, that you might have Callum taken away from you.
Yes, and it was a very real fear that I thought if I go public with this and I seek some treatment, people could think I was a bad mother and someone could take my child away from me.
Awful, awful. Tim, it must have been hard for you because I suppose the man tends to get forgotten in these situations, but difficult for you as well.
Very difficult from a man's side, although nothing compared to what Shelley's been through. The man doesn't know what's wrong and therefore doesn't know how to help, and we try and help around the house, but things just get worse and worse. And it's just good now that we know what is going on.
Finally, you're getting treatment. Hopefully this treatment will work, and we wish you the very, very best. Thank you very much for getting in touch with us. So a story here, hopefully with a happy ending. Shelley's now getting the treatment she needs, but such a common story around the country.
OK, Jackie, thanks very much indeed. Now, Dr. Hiller has been sitting here watching all of this, and I know has been looking at some of the huge response we had when we were speaking about this yesterday. Are you surprised by how many people reacted and how many people are going through this?
I'm not surprised, and I'm really delighted that so many people have actually sat up and taken notice and said, look, you know, it's almost like we've given them permission to say, actually, I feel like that. It's so very common. Mm. Maybe up to 20% of women who've just had babies actually not just even just had babies, but may have had babies some months or even more than a year ago, who are still feeling despondent and down and exhausted, may well be depressed with postnatal illness. And it is such, you know, people say very often in our emails, they said, it's the worst experience of my life. I don't understand why I feel like this. I don't want to feel like this, but sometimes I just think that I need to protect my baby from this rotten world and do something
dangerous. Yes, it's
quite interesting.
A lot of the calls today are saying, but sometimes the examples are that with the people you talk to say, I hated myself, I hated my baby, even though deep down inside I knew I loved the baby. They're also saying that sometimes it can react the other way, that you have a paranoid fear of any harm coming to your baby. And there are quite a few calls saying, you know, it wasn't that she didn't like the baby, didn't want to be with it, it's just that she almost didn't know how to live or get out of the house because she was
That's
so paranoid. Yeah, so it can go either way, can't
That's right, there are a whole range of symptoms. What I would like to mention is that a lot of our emails said that, you know, they've come through that long, dark tunnel, and they now feel totally better again. The baby is the best thing that's ever happened to them, greatest thing in the world. And what's encouraging is that those women are the ones who got the help.
Yeah.
And what so I would say, they've got to go and get the help.
Very briefly, what causes it? Is it a physiological, hormonal changes, or is it a mess of things?
It's all of those things. Yeah. It's very complex. Sometimes it's what happened during the pregnancy, a difficult pregnancy. Sometimes it's a difficult birth or a birth that doesn't live up to your expectations of the birth. Mm. Sometimes it's being isolated, not having the support afterwards, not having any practical help, just being exhausted, having pain from the birth, from a difficult breastfeeding, a previous history of depression. It could be a whole number of things, including hormones.
And what's the best thing to do if you fear that either you or somebody you know is going through this?
Talk about it. Talk about it with your partner. Mm. Talk about it with your family and your close friends.
And there's help out there.
Don't be ashamed of it.
No.
Yeah, go to your GP, talk to your health visitor, talk to your midwife, and get continual support. And don't be worried about medication, because although talking therapy is good and meeting other mums in the same position to share it with is good, medication, although people are wary of it, can be extremely effective. Just as effective as taking, you know, a painkiller for your headache, an antidepressant can sometimes make a huge difference. Safe as houses and used correctly can make a huge difference.
Okay, Hilary, brilliant. Thanks very much indeed. You can join Dr. Hilary as well. We're going to look at this. We've had so much response. He's doing a live video web chat at 9:30. There he is on our website, looking particularly handsome. If you have any questions on coping with postnatal depression, do log on to gm.tv and he'll be speaking over the net there.
Coming up, we're going to be meeting the mother who's given birth to twins with a difference, because one is white and the other one is black. It's very, very true. One in a million chance, apparently. You're going to see it very shortly.
And Rod's all set to rock. Yes, Rod Stewart is tuning in to perform for us after the break.
OK, it's 5 minutes to nine. We're going to get the weather for you now. Here's Andrea.
And so for the north of England and North Wales, GMTV
weather, sponsored by Nestle Cereals. Whole grain for the whole family every morning.
Hello there, good morning. Now, we do have quite a wet start to the day for, again, southern counties of England and Wales. As we put the rest of the graphics on, you can see that that's where the heaviest of the rain in is, but it doesn't necessarily mean everyone else is dry, because we have parts of Scotland seeing a wet start. It's grey across the borders region into northern England. What we will see as we go into this afternoon is that area of rain that's pushing in from the south and west will continue to feed its way northwards, the heaviest of that rain always out to the west, so that's western parts of Wales, the West Country, and eventually it will merge with the rain that's across Scotland at the moment. So again, that means the borders region into Northern Ireland could well see some fairly heavy and persistent outbreaks of rain. Now, the Shetland Isles, you could well see some sunny outbreaks through today, but it doesn't necessarily make you the warmest place. As you can see, temperatures struggling a touch, only getting up to around 8 or 9. Could well see temperatures getting into the mid-teens further south, but because it is going to be a wee bit breezy and it'll also be so wet, it probably won't feel like it. So, the next couple of days, what have we got in store? More of the same, really. It's been a bit of a damp half-term holiday, I'm sorry to say, which I know makes it so difficult when trying to think of things to do with the kids. It is going to be maybe a better day tomorrow, I think. You'll see a little bit more in the way of sunshine for England and Wales, remaining rather breezy and wet for Scotland, remaining that way into Friday. Temperatures, well, as they have been, really. You can see tomorrow's going to be a touch warmer, then they'll sink down again for Friday, 15, 16 degrees for the weekend. It looks like Sunday could well be the better day of the two, if you've got to make a choice. And really, that's because we'll see a wetter day for Scotland on Saturday compared to Sunday. Easy summary.
For your local five-day weather update, visit our website, gm.tv.
Now then, as promised, here's Rod Stewart performing Still the Same, a Bob Seger classic from his new album. Enjoy.
You're always one, every time you placed a bet. You're still damn good, no one's gotten to you yet. Every time they were shot at you caught, you were quicker than they thought. You just turned your back and walked. Always said the cards would never do you wrong. The trick you said was
Just never play the game too long. A gambler's share, the only risk that you could take, the only loss you could foresee, the only bluff you could not think, and you're still the same, caught up with your yesterday. Moving gate to gate, no one standing in your way. Turning on the charm, long enough to get you back. You're still the same, you still aim high. Stood, everybody watched you play. I just turned and walked away. I had nothing left to say. Cause you're still the same. Oh yeah, you're still the same. Moving game to game. Oh yeah, you still the same. You still the same. You still the same. You still the same.
He's a legend. Brilliant.
There you go. Well done. Thank you very much, Ross.
What's he looking out for there? You never know, do you?
Trying to see if you've woken up.
Ah,
that's what it is.
True.
Now then, all babies are special, but we're about to meet two that are one in a million or two in a million. Meet Leighton and Caden Richardson, her twin boys, but as you can see, they're anything but identical. Not just because Leighton's awake and
Caden's still fast asleep. The other one's slumped to sleep.
But of course, one's white and one is black. And they're here with their mother, Kerry, and Hillary's with us as well. Kerry, first things first, congratulations on two gorgeous little boys. They are lovely as well. Are you enjoying being a mum?
Yeah, it's brilliant.
When you got first were told you were having twins, what was your reaction?
I was in total shock. I was like, couldn't believe it.
Was there twins in the family before?
My nana's got nieces who were twins, but like not in immediate family or close family, no.
Okay, so you come to terms with the fact you're having two babies, not one, and that's going to be difficult enough. So when they were actually born, did you know immediately that they were going to be different colours?
No, I mean, although Caden did come out with the dark hair and eyes, and Leighton come out with the fair hair, they were still the same skin colour. So it was only like about 3-4 weeks after they were born, like Caden started to change colour, get darker.
And what was your immediate reaction when you start saying, I'm sure that Caden's getting a little bit darker, and what's
happening? Yeah, it was like, you're looking at it and I'm thinking, well, maybe he'll stay that colour, and then like every day went by, you start to get that little bit more darker. So you just like, it was actually other people commenting on it that made it like seem more real. And
yeah. Did you go to your doctor and say, is there something wrong? I don't understand what's happening here.
No, I mean, no one actually. I mean, when they went for the injections, like, they did pick up on the colours and said it's unusual, but then nothing.
Wow. So, Hillary, this is an extraordinary situation. Oh, there was a couple in the a couple of babies in Australia just recently that have been born like this. Doesn't happen very often, though, does it?
Not at all. No, I didn't do much genetics in medical school, but here we go. I'll try and explain this. Kerry is mixed English-Jamaican heritage.
Nigerian,
I beg your pardon. So she will have genetic coding for both dark skin and light skin in her makeup. So she produces one egg, which becomes Caden, which has a predominance of genes for dark skin and vice versa for Leighton. Which it's extraordinarily rare to have one egg with just the genes for dark skin, but to make another egg at the same time with a predominance of genes for white skin is even more rare. So they are literally one in a million. It is very, very unusual, perfectly possible.
And the boy's father, is he white?
Yeah.
So does that add to the possibility of it happening as well?
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, it all goes into the mix, and what you get is the genes at the end. They've got 50% of the same genes. these two brothers. So it's uncanny. And they do have lots of similarities, you know, the bone structure.
They're very similar, the little expressions and everything.
Right. And you do see, I mean, in general practice, you see people all the time with more than one baby who are of slightly different colour.
Yes.
So it's perfectly possible.
Have you thought about the future, Gary, in terms of how you're going to expand? I mean, because as they're growing up and what's the situation going to be like growing up?
Yeah, we'll explain them, like, we'll try the best, because I'm no medical expert, but I will try and explain them, and then hopefully...
They're just very, very special boys.
That's yeah, definitely.
And they look absolutely gorgeous. They've been so well-behaved as well.
Yeah, they're
absolutely
brilliant.
I tell you what, if only all babies were like these two, they're absolutely magic. Thank you very much for coming in, Karen.
Right,
and do enjoy them as well. Hilary, thanks very much as well.
Why don't you order one of those?
One to come like that. One. Happy, smiley, look, it's a gorgeous hello.
Hello. Oh, for heaven's sake. Ben's going to be cooing now, isn't he?
I'm going to start dribbling as well.
I know. Join in with them. Hey, listen, it's time to get technical.
He's bored of you.
Techno Trends, sponsored by thebestof.co.uk. The smart way to find the best of local business.
Now, if you want to get ahead on all the latest electronics that'll be in the shops in the UK in a year's time, you might want to consider getting yourself over to South Korea. OK, well, Richard Gaisford's been sampling the best gizmos in Seoul.
Technologies are born in South Korea that set trends for the rest of the world. Here in Seoul, they're currently showcasing some of the latest gadgets and gizmos that may still be months or years away from hitting our shores.
Well, you know, the Koreans are selling every sort of television to the world, from mobile miniature pictures on your handset that are crystal clear to this, one of the biggest television sets on the planet. At 102 inches across, it's formidable. Every single picture is pin sharp. It's what they call full high definition. For the last few years, manufacturers have been trying to work out exactly what combination of gadgets we want in one pocket-sized device. This lot think they've done it. They've got a 6-megapixel camera there, a digital music player, and mobile TV, all in one very handy little box. If Korean designers had their way, every front room would look like this, a true cinema in your house with real special cinema sound.
Well,
let me just translate for you and tell you what she's saying. She's telling them that this is the latest in DVD technology. It's called Blu-ray. It's high-definition DVD. And if you've gone out and invested in one of these big HD-ready televisions for your home, then when these things arrive in the shop, it's what you're going to want to plug into it.
So that's what's coming soon, and this is what's available now here in South Korea.
It certainly looks like gadget heaven, and the scary thing is there's 12 more floors just like this to explore.
Prices are a little lower than at home, and the choice is amazing.
Well, this is the kind of technology I love. The idea is you stand on this wobbling and vibrating platform, you can feel it all the way through your body, shaking you about. And it's exercise without actually having to move.
Finally, my search is over. Like a child in the sweet shop, my technological taste buds have been truly satisfied.
Well, here it is, the latest and the greatest from Korea, a 10-megapixel camera phone. And look, it's even got a proper zoom built in the back as well. Well, if you've ever had a nightmare choosing a mobile phone, this place could prove a problem for you. It's just one floor of one store. And look at it, it has to be, what, 4 football pitches wide, and all it's selling is phones. Take a look, there is such a large choice, and there's so many features that we just don't see back home. What they tend to do is try things out here in Korea. If it works, well, then they'll sell it to the world.
He'll have stocked up, won't he, Average?
Oh, he'll have sack loads.
I'm surprised he came back.
I know, he'll be selling them out the inside of his coat. Like a dodgy dealer later on. Now, there's more on South Korea's obsession with technology on our website. That's gm.tv.
He's suggesting he's got a flasher's Mac.
I didn't use that connection. Okay. He might have something to keep out the rain.
That was the image
but
I had.
It's nothing to do with a flasher's Mac.
Still to come this morning, Simon Cowell is coming back on the sofa, talking more to the acid-tongued X-Factor judge about his merciless streak and his move into the world of cosmetics.
Apparently, they're going to get an aftershave. Eau de Cal.
Yes, following in the footsteps of David Hasselhoff, Jade Goody.
Yes, Henry Cooper. All the greats. The row over Michael J. Fox showing the visible signs of Parkinson's disease in a political advert. That's going on in America. We're going to go live to LA to talk to Carla to find out more about that. See you in a minute. Now, the fate of the X Factor finalists was in this man's hands yet again on Saturday night when he had to choose between soul singer Robert and vocal harmony group for sure. Let's have a look at the moment of truth.
The artist I am going to send home is... for sure.
Is there even a little bit of you that feels sick inside to watch their dreams crushed before you?
No.
No.
I think I told...
Why not?
Well, just this, that's the show, isn't it? I think I told Louis that I was going to keep his group that week as well.
Oh, so you watched his dreams crushed.
I whispered over, I said, don't worry, they're safe. And then I kicked them out.
Do you ever feel guilty? Does there any bit of you that thinks maybe I should soften, sweeten the pill a little bit?
No. I don't think there's any other way of doing it. You know, the public have voted these two in the bottom two, so someone's going to have to go home. I'm very happy that I'm the one making the decision.
Look at that grin.
Yeah.
Hey, listen, there's a survey out that says that you are only the 10th most scary man on British television. Gordon Ramsay is number one. You must be furious.
Not really, no. Who else is on there?
I don't
know,
actually.
There?
I'm not, and I am quite scary, but I'm not a man.
Off camera, you can be very scary. Bit of a predator.
Bit of a predator? Don't say this.
You
this
have
is
a
not
reputation
true at all.
For that.
I don't have a reputation for it at all.
All right, you don't.
This is how it starts.
Okay,
this is how you destroy people.
All right. Another Kate.
I quite like the idea of being a predator, actually. That's quite nice. Keep it going. When you started, didn't you start out as a gopher in the mailroom of a record company?
Yeah.
Did you think then, I'd like to be running this, I know better than other people?
Yeah, even at the age of 18, I thought I knew more.
Did you?
I probably did.
So not at all a confidence problem then?
Never had a confidence problem. I mean, listen, I took a few knocks along the way, Kate, and the interesting thing was, I learned more from people being honest and truthful with me, and actually quite harsh about it, than I did all this sort of patronising, oh, everything's fine, Simon. Pete Waterman was somebody who became my mentor when I was in my mid-20s. And it was tough love. And that's why I'm always very realistic with the contestants on the show. I don't want to patronise them. If they're terrible, tell them they're terrible.
And it's certainly very successful. I mean, it's huge in America as well. You've got so many shows. What's this inventor show? We don't get it over here. That's been so
you might
successful.
Do. It's
might
a, yeah, it's a show we've made in America. It's like X Factor, but for inventors and inventions. Mm-hmm. A very, very popular show in America, and we're making the second season next year.
You've had some good ones come out of it?
Not really, no.
So popular, but rubbish.
Yeah, all rubbish, yeah. I mean, all sorts of weird stuff. But it's a funny show.
Yeah.
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 And, I mean, you've got so many different projects. I understand you might also be bringing out an aftershave. Is this true? Eau de Cal?
Well,
or is
no.
this completely
no.
made up?
No. No. No, actually, true? Some snotty guy in the paper said, who'd want to smell like Simon?
Yeah, I know.
He's
I know.
Probably
is,
right, actually.
Says, Steve Chaliotis says, aftershave needs to be on someone who's seen as a style leader. So the link-up with Simon Cowell surprises me,
well,
which I think is a little bit harsh.
Can I just add, Mr. Whatever Your Name Is, Kevin Keegan was promoting Brute a few years ago. And who is the boxer?
Well, there's many boxers.
Okay, the
Henry
famous
Cooper.
Henry Cooper. Yeah, yes. The famous Brute. Anyway, the answer is I'm not going to do an
and
aftershave.
And also... high-waisted trousers are now back in, which I think is single-handedly down to you.
Yes, so whoever your silly
Dash
name
you.
Is, Mr. Whatever you are, I do have an influence.
Okay.
Yeah.
Thankfully, it's mainly on music.
No, but I'm not doing an aftershave, no.
You're not?
I have been offered by a company in America to do a skincare kind of, you know, that's where the story came about
Ooh,
from.
Ooh, so you could look as youthful and fresh as Mr. Cow.
Yes.
Oh, wonderful. Maybe you should slip me some. It's been great to see you this morning.
Why are you
Thanks very much. I'm not laughing. I'm being taking it very seriously.
You're not.
No. It's nervousness.
Okay.
You're making me scared.
Yeah, right.
You're number one to me,
yeah,
scariest
yeah, yeah.
man in the UK. Good to see you this morning.
Nice to see you.
Skincare. Going to be interesting. Competition time now. Someone's about to win £10,000. Earlier on, we asked you this question. In Vegas, there are many what? Nearly ski slopes, but it's actually casinos. would you believe it? There's quite a few lakes as well, to be honest. The computer has picked the finalists at random. They're all in the hats. Miss Gadaway.
Okay, I'll have a little rummage.
Feeling a bit predatory?
I'm not predatory. He's an evil man, thank goodness. Oh, God, I've got two out. What do I do?
Okay, let me choose between the two. Okay. I'm going to go for that one.
Right.
It is now Ben Leonard.
Ben Leonard. It's a good morning for you. You threw me with that predatory accusation. You and Carl are in cahoots.
Okay, we're going to cross to Los Angeles. Carl is there for us this morning.
Not if anyone's predatory.
There she is in her.
This is what I appear on for, thank you.
Now, look, Carla, before we get into that, we've been looking at pictures of Michael J. Fox all morning making an appeal for, I'm not sure, what was he doing?
Basically, this has sparked major controversy over here, I can't tell you. He has appeared in a political advert for a Democrat Senate candidate who supports stem cell research. So this is, I guess, Michael J. Fox appearing in something that's pretty close to his heart. As we know, he suffers from Parkinson's disease. Now, you'll look at the advert in a second, but he is shaking, visibly shaking and jerking quite a lot. Take a look at this first.
As you might know, I care deeply about stem cell research. In Missouri, you can elect Claire McCaskill, who shares my hope for cures. Unfortunately, Senator Jim Talent opposes expanding stem cell research. Senator Talent even wanted to criminalize the science that gives us a chance for hope. They say all politics is local, but it's not always the case. What you do in Missouri matters to millions of Americans, Americans like me.
Okay, so why the controversy? Michael J. Fox clearly has Parkinson's. What's the row about? I'll tell you why. Because one conservative radio DJ out here, very big DJ called Rush Limbaugh, has said that he just doesn't buy it. That he thinks that Michael J. Fox was exaggerating his illness, that he was either acting or he was off his medication. Either way, he just didn't believe that it was true, and he thinks that his illness was being exploited for political gain. Now, as you can imagine, very hurtful words to somebody who's suffering from Parkinson's disease. A lot of people have various views about it here, but Michael J. Fox's reaction, I have to say, was pretty gracious.
Well, it's hard for people, and I understand it's difficult for people that don't have Parkinson's or don't know about Parkinson's to understand the symptoms and the way they work and the way medication works. You get what you get on any given day.
I don't think that this Rush Limbaugh will be showing his face anytime soon, barricading himself in the house, no doubt, guys.
And to be honest, it's create more of a furore and actually pushed Michael J. Fox's campaign, I would say.
Well, exactly. It's probably quite a good thing in the end of the day for the actual campaign, yeah.
Good, jolly good. Now then, look, more developments with the long-awaited Oprah interview with Madonna.
Yes, I've got to tell you, I think people in America are practically rushing out and getting the snacks and the beers in, ready for the big interview. It's already been recorded. It's going to be aired here later on today. But we've already got a rough idea of what's been said because of the people who were in the audience. They basically told us that Madonna was very emotional, close to tears, when she was talking about the accusations levelled against her, the fact that she adopted this 13-month-old baby boy because of publicity. Now, a lot of this controversy, I've got to say, involves the fact that the baby's father has now come out and said he never intended to have his baby adopted. He wasn't aware of the full facts. He thought it was just some sort of temporary solution and didn't realise he was actually signing his baby away. Madonna, on the other hand, says that he was very happy to have his baby adopted. In the year that his baby was in the orphanage, not one member of the family went to go and see him. Now, this is a bit of a twist here. According to Malawian law, international adoption is illegal. So you have to go through a big vetting process for over a year. And people are saying that Madonna has tried to sway that, tried to use her influence, tried to use her status to flout that law. She says she did nothing wrong, but she did admit that they kind of made up the law as they went along. But the plot thickens because later this week, there's going to be human rights groups that are going to go and see a judge in Malawi and ask him to review this case. So, I mean, there's an awful lot involved here for Madonna. I feel quite sorry for her in that she tried to do something good and it's backfired spectacularly.
Yeah, absolutely. Carla, I'm afraid we're out of time, but thank you very much.
You've got to tell us about it tomorrow, though, I'm sure.
Yes, and a great pink top she had on as well.
Very nice.
Predatory, some might say.
She's going to tell me off afterwards. You have a lovely day. We'll see you tomorrow.
Bye-bye.
Take care. Bye. Tomorrow.